Saddle up and ride your pony now on 4. This is live Channel 4 Racing.
Sport on 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
Good afternoon, everyone. Well, there are surprises, big surprises, and then there's racing at Catterick on a frosty January afternoon. But despite the worst the weather could throw at it all week, the course this morning got the all clear when Christopher Tetley and his hard-working groundsman and a member of the stewards panel, they walked the course, gave it the thumbs up. The temperature didn't dip any lower than 0 degrees overnight. And the jockeys who rode in the first spoke to three of them as they came in. A couple of them said it's pretty slow. It's officially good to soft, but perfectly safe. And by way of a bonus, we've got 5 races for you live, not 4 as we told you on the morning line, because we're also going to include the Darlington Conditional Jockey Selling Handicap Hurdle over 2 miles. That comes up shortly. Then, half an hour later, can Peter Niven take another winner towards his magical 1,000? He's 6th in the jockey's all-time list, and he partners the hot favourite, Shrivar. That race is sponsored by the Stanley Organisation, who also put up the money, or some of the money, for our next affair, a novices handicap chase over 2 miles. Then it's probably our best contest of the day, the Leaming Handicap Chase over an extended 3 miles. And then, finally, Mary Reevely has hot favourite, the major, in the Beedale Novices Chase. A couple of non-runners to mention. Charity Crusader doesn't take part in our first race. That's because the horse box that was originally bringing Mary Reevely's runners broke down, but the others should get here all right. And then in the Leaming Handicap Chase, Inch Champion is a non-runner.
Well, Jim, in contrast here at Lingfield, it's all quiet, with racing having been abandoned at around 8:15 this morning due to the freezing conditions. The Equitrack surface was found to contain various hard lumps, and it was felt that these lumps would have been a danger to both horses and riders, and that they were unlikely to disperse by the time of the scheduled first race. But we're still here to watch the racing at Catterick with you, and in between those races to discuss a whole range of racing matters with me are John Frankham and Big Mac, and we'll also have a champion tipster competition to look ahead to today on the 4 live races at Catterick, beginning with the 2 o'clock race. The usual rules apply, and the number to ring is 0901 56 448 44.
So let's get on with our bonus race for you, the Conditional Jockeys Selling Handicap. One non-runner here, just confirm that again to you. Number 7, Charity Crusader, doesn't take part. So that leaves a field of 14. Runners and riders confirmed to you by Graham.
And they're already down at the start for this race, with Saxon Victory 25-1 chance, Blinker Today, Lee Vickers rides, Pandora's Lord 10-1, Peter Ryan, to the last man, 16s, Niall Hannity, and Lucky Ganesha 16-1, Dominic Ellsworth on rides that one. Number 5 is Barley Meadow 14-1, Visored, Liam Cooper's Mount, Kirsham is 5-1, Richard McGrath, Mount and Dream 20-1, Jim Crowley rides. Number 9, By the Glass, 12-1, Graham Lee. Phase 8 Girl, 12-1, Tom Siddle's Matt. Mill Afrique is a 3-1 favourite, Alan Dempsey. And Crookwood Water, 10-1, David Finley rides, its visored runner. Number 13, Navan Project, 10-1, Tony Ross. Matardi, 16-1, Vince Keane and Andy Klein. Only a 6-1 chance, Jody Mogford for the Alan Bailey yard.
Well, if you can find the winner of this, you're off to a good start. It's Mill Afrique, who's attracted a bit of money, 3-1 favourite. Kirsham, stepping back in distance, ran well over for a long way over 2.5 miles last time, a 5-1 shot. Andy Clyde is 6-1, 10's Panora's Lord, good old stick, Phase 8 girl, and Crookford Water, the same price, Navan Project, and they don't really want to know about the others. Well, John Frankham and John McCriddick are sitting down in Lingfield, not doing very much, and I know Frank's been looking at the form of this. John, have you got a selection for us?
Well, we think Mary Reeve has been hatching a bit of a plot here, Jim, because she's got two runners, or had two runners, and yet one number seven, Charity Crusader, hasn't made it because apparently the horse box broke down. Seems very unlikely to me that they came in separate horse boxes. So, Mill Afrique, get on, son.
No chance, because he's walked all the way to the course, the horse will be exhausted.
Yeah.
That was the excuse officially offered, John. I have to say, Mary Reevely has got an awful lot of runners today, so it wouldn't be a surprise if they came in different horse boxes. But anyway, if that's your reason for going for it, let's say it's a novel idea, a novel way of selecting one. So, certainly got an informed rider in Alan Dempsey on board. Graham, how do you subscribe to that view?
No, James. There are more than one horse boxer to be had in Cleveland this day and age. Waiting on Saxon Victory to come in here, the beige jacket for Val Ward. Mill Afrique 3-1, 5-1 about Kirsham. Crookford Water, nobody wants that on the slide out to 12-1. But Andy Clyde, that's an interesting runner from the Alan Bailey yard. Hasn't shown much form, but very lightly weighted. Soundly beaten in two runs this year, but drops to the lowest grade today at the bottom weight. And a most competent jockey in Jody Mogford riding. That's in the starred sleeve jacket in the centre of our picture there, lining up. So too is Saxon Victory, but away they go, and the jolly old favourite, Mill Afrique, was slow to go. That's in the dark blue with the white chevron. But up front on the inside, we've got Andy Clive with the pace early on, and also up there to the last man. And these are in the air together on the inside. Panora's Lord, not that far away. On the inside is the only grey in the race, Navin Projects, who's running prominently very early on. Kirsham goes behind that, and they've got a very long stride on before they take flight number two. By the glasses and the pale colours. So they come down towards flight number two then. The grey Navin Project just has the edge to Andy Clyde in the star jacket. Nearest to us, Panora's Lord in the yellow. In the green, we've got Mutadi. Kirsham is on the right of the picture with those yellow sleeves. The red and black sleeves of Lady Ganesha as they skip over flight number two. The orange and white went up in the air a bit was Phase 8 Girl. Short run towards flight number three now. And as they come to it, it's Andy Clyde that just has the advantage too on the inside. Navin Project, these are one and two. Then Panora's Lord is on the stand side racing in third. And then behind these we got to the last man. Barley Meadow not that far away. Mutadi's through on the inside. The trailer is Phase 8 Girl. And the favourite, Mill Afrique, last but one as they come past the Lollipop with a lap in front of them and out onto the far side. And we close in on Navin Project, the grey, as they head up the rise on the far side of the track. Just a slight problem getting into the car parks early on. Sadly, there was quite a serious accident on the just off the A1. It was cleared up. But it's going to be Navin Project leading as they turn towards the back straight. Navin Project with the edge here, only just to Andy Clyde on the outer. These are going one and two. And then into third place, we have Panora's Lord, Kirsham, just in front of Mutadi. And a length behind these comes to the last man. Crookford Water down the pack, so too is Mountain Dream. Lady Ganesha with the black sleeves on the right of the picture tries to make a stride or two, but as they cross the first of three flights of hurdles on the far side, it's going to be Navin Project on the inside of Andy Clyde without wide Panora's Law, one, two and three. Mutadi racing in fourth place, and then these are closely attended by Kirsham. Lady Ganesha is making a bit of ground on the outside. And towards the back now is Saxon Victory. Don't think he'll be victorious. Continuing the run down the back straight. This is the last on the back straight, and it's Navin Project, the grey, with Andy Clyde on the outside. On the left of the leading three in the yellow and green, that's Panora's Lord. The spotted colours, Mutadi and Vince Keane going closer, with the black sleeves on the outside. Lucky Ganesha getting well into the argument. From the back, we can tell you that Mill Afrique is starting to pick up as they start the turn out of the back straight, and it's Panora's Lord that goes into the lead here. But look, in second place, those green and white colours. Mutadi swinging along on the outside of Navin Project with the black sleeves. Lucky Ganesha, ridden by Dominic Ellsworth, a very competent jockey in fourth place. These are going in front of Andy Clyde, so that little tickle in the market probably won't be landed. Only 14 runners. Mill Afrique is starting to stay on. Mountain Dream is coming wrong strongly too. That's the one with the noseband on the left of the picture in the pink and maroon jacket. But look at this. Mutadi has gone clear. They've only got about just over a quarter of a mile to go. Lucky Ganesha's whizzing through on the inside, and Dom just puts the goggles down a bit. But but it's Mutardi with a clear lead as they come down towards the second last. Mutardi with the advantage and jumps it soundly. Lucky Ganesh will be iffy in second, and then Panora's Law, Kirshen behind these, then the grey ridden along Navan Project, but there's only one more flight of hurdles to be jumped in this selling race, and it's Mutardi with a clear lead. Here comes to it, he pops over it well. Lucky Ganesha flicks to the top in second place. Back in third, we've got Mountain Dream and Kirshen, but playing for places only as the runaway winner here is Mutardi, who's coming home in grand style here. And at the line, it's going to be Mutardi who wins it in the end quite easily. Big absence since his last run, but he's done it well. Lucky Ganesha is in second place. Mountain Dream comes third, then Kirshen in front of Crookford Water, and then Navan Project after these, Barley Meadow. Milau Freak never showed, so perhaps Big Mac was right, he did walk here in the end. Andy Clive finished to beat only two, and one of those was Phase 8 Girl, and the other one's coming home by Christmas. And so the result then of this sell-up, it's gone to horse number 14, this one Mutardi, in the Clark jacket, trained at Sutton the Forest by Steve Clark, ridden by Vince Green, and it's going to be a big price, this. Second horse home was number four. This is Lucky Ganesha, ridden by Dom Ellsworth. And the third horse home is number eight, Mountain Dream. It's won by 10 lengths, four lengths separating second and third. Easy.
Well, off the track for nearly 2 years and an outsider, but backed at long odds, 25s into 16 just before the off. And for those who had a little tickle, well, the result was never in doubt, and this horse jumps the last two hurdles like a fresh animal. Lucky Ganesha gives vain chase, and those who tried to come from a long way off the pace were never able to get into it. It is pretty sharp, this circuit round here. It jumps out almost like a fence under Vince Keane. This throw out from the flat, he's related to Celtic Swing, Moon Madness, all that family. He's obviously nowhere near that ability, but he's been more than good enough here. Comes to the last now, and measures it really well, runs on with plenty of gusto, and Lucky Ganesha stays on to be a game, if well beaten, second. So, you're punting this afternoon, unless you were in on a mini gamble, let's say, let's not exaggerate it, the late support for our winner here, I think most of you will have done your money.
Big drop in class down to selling race company, that Mutardi, and that probably told the story of how the horse was able to win. Returned 16-1, as Jimbo said, did touch 25-1 and 20-1 on the course. Lucky Ganesha was runner-up at 16-1 with Mountain Dream third at 20-1. Milau Freak, who was last in the early stages, never got in the race. The 11-4 favourite, and I think my theory was right, greatest. It had to walk 25 miles, roughly, from Saltburn to the course that sunk it. It was exhausted.
The way it ran, I think they walked it there. Remember, they'd forgotten something. Walked it back again, then came back to the course.
One thing's certain, there's nobody going to be of the opinion that Messrs Frankham and McCrurick are taking this afternoon seriously, but we are, and when you rejoin us after the break, we'll be talking to one of the most successful jump jockeys of all time and attempting to solve a bit of a query. Join us soon.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Search for intelligent life. That is my life, waiting for something to respond to me. But the answer is only miles, not light years away. The new Toyota Avensis with satellite navigation and a responsive VVTi engine. So, if it's out there, what am I doing here?
The new Toyota Avensis.
It's time to phone for the new Eclipse Summer Sun brochure. Hundreds of great holidays from Mallorca to Mexico, personally approved by our customers. With no travel agent's commission to pay, they're great value, and you can book direct from home 7 days a week. So get the free Summer Sun brochure that shows you what customers actually think. Call Eclipse Holidays now on 0870 0102 032.
You've awakened to the true power of e-business. Do you have the software to manage it? If not, consider this your wake-up call. software manages more e-businesses than anyone else on Earth. Hello Tomorrow, we are Computer Associates, the software that manages e-business.
How would you like to be driving one of these someday?
Whatever your dream, Bonus Cash Builder Plus can help make it come true. This special savings plan from MIS and AXA Sun Life helps you build up a guaranteed cash sum over 15 years. The money is then yours to spend as you wish, so you could have that holiday of a lifetime, buy a brand new car, or give the kids a great start in life. The choice is yours, and thanks to MIS, you'll also get half your money back after just 1 year. Over 150,000 people are already enjoying the benefits of saving with Bonus Cash Builder Plus. So what are they saving for?
A new car, something sporty.
We're saving for our daughter's future.
Join them today. Just call this number now, 0800 850 650. You'll receive details of this 15-year savings plan with premiums starting from just £10 initially. And choose one of these free gifts to welcome you as a new saver. So call now on 0800 850 650 and look forward to a richer future with Bonus Cash Builder Plus.
Sport on 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
And the tote returns in that cellar, 16 to 1 the winner, of course. And the tote return, and it pays £16.10, so just under the SP. 15, just over 15 to 1 the winner. Places £6.40, £6.20 and £5.90. The exacta, £411.10. And the computer straight forecast, £230.85. Well, I just don't know, great one, that Miller Freak, last very early on, and never really seemed to be put in the race to get in the race with a chance.
Well, she was dropping back in distance, so you'd expect her to have jumped off and been handy from the start. And there's no doubt she's one to keep an eye on. I'm not at Catterick, so I wasn't there to see her when she pulled up. But to my way of speaking, she's open to plenty of improvement. And if the stewards don't have some sort of inquiry, then I'll be really surprised. Alan Dempsey, hands and heels, not doing very much. But just have a look at the way he rides now. He's just sitting, squeezing, giving her a little bit of a flick down the ear. Just watch. Ears pricks. Jumped the last. Didn't jump the last particularly like a tire.
The horse is hanging, though.
She's not hanging at all, for God's sake. Now just have a look. Suddenly, 100 yards from the line, we'll see a little bit more vigour now. And I'd say certainly one for the notebook.
Well, interesting to hear their views. Just to confirm that the runner that did take part for Mary Reevely there was in the main horse box, which brought six horses, but the one which withdrawn was coming on its own, and lo and behold, that horse box broke down. Anyway, let's get you up to date with what happened here in our first race at Catterick. Racing got underway at 12.55. Quite an interesting novice hurdle here. Not a bad betting heat either. On the off, let's just check the odds. Bad Out of the Blue was just favourite, I think around the 2-1 mark, just ahead of a couple of his main rivals, who were Winchester, who'd run well at Haydock the time before, and Ashgar, an 11-4 shot.
So it's Winchester in the lead, that's in the red and blue colours. On the inside goes Ashgar. Bat of the Blue is racing very wide as they come down the home straight. And it's Winchester with the advantage to Ashgar. This is a 3 mile stretch, 3 mile race, and they're going to be very tired indeed now. The tempo's rising with Winchester in the lead from Ashgar on the right. They've gone a long way clear of Bat on the Blue back in third place, and the rest are out of them. Very few have got into it. Coming down towards the final flight now as they do so, it's going to be Winchester with the advantage, made a lot of the running. Ashgar having his first run over hurdles, got a little bit low there and nods on landing, and really does have legs of jelly there. The very weary horse, Winchester, the fitter one today, stays on the better, and Winchester up towards the line. Tom Siddle rides the winner, Malcolm Jefferson trains, Ashgar a battling brave second, but not good enough on the day. Winchester with the winner, Ashgar is second, and goodness gracious me, a very long way back to the third, Bat Out of the Blue.
Experience tells for Winchester, return the 9-4. Clear second favourite. 9-4 Winchester beats Ashgar at 11-4, and many people, if they met again on the same terms, would back Ashgar to reverse the placings, with Bat Out of the Blue a very distant third at 7-4 favourite. The tote win, £3.20, places £1.10, £1.40 or £1.40, the exacta £13.10, and the computer straight forecast £8.11.
And the next race at Catterick is the first leg of the Champion Tipster competition, the 2 o'clock race. Four races today. Usual rules, three selections per race. Points scored according to starting prices by placed horses, a 10-point bonus for every winner, and the top total scoring £5 per point. The number to ring, 0901 56448 44. Last chance.
Well, it's been one of the interesting facets of the season so far has been Peter Niven's quest to ride 1,000 winners. He's the sixth most successful jump jockey of all time. Where does that put him in perspective to the greats of the sport who had the list? Richard Dunwoody with 1,699 winners, Peter Scudamore 1,678, and then Tony McCoy 1,274. So Niven's a fair way behind there, but 996 is ahead of the likes of Mark Dwyer, John Joe O'Neill, Graham McCourt. And the gentleman concerned is with me now. Peter, there's a bit of an argument about this because I read a big feature on you last week in the Times. It said 996, and you think it's that, but you tell me that someone else says it's not that many.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's the Racing Post. John Randall at the Racing Post says it have another five, but who's to argue with John Randall? I mean, he answered a lot more questions than I did in Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, but I don't know.
Yeah, but you're a Scot, and Scots are always good with figures.
Yeah, well, I mean, I did count up because there was this argument, and I counted up the other day, and my wife checked it, and it's 996. So,
so there's four to go as far as you're concerned.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully I'll keep riding anyway. So, I'd like to think it will be immaterial, you know.
Now, I know you're sick to death of questions, but there's a lot of Southern viewers. All the questions I'm going to ask you, a lot of Southern viewers that don't see you very often. You were first jockey for Mary Reeve. You had a very bad injury. You were out for a while, and now you seem to be one of a pool of jockeys. She's got some very good young ones, but you're not getting as many rides as you used to. I mean, you used to be automatic first choice for most things up here.
Yeah, obviously that's the way you'd have to speak to Mary really to get a clear outlook on it. I just know as much as you really. You hope to see your name against the horse, and if you do, you ride it. You know, I still go in there quite often, and. There's some owners in the yard that have been very good to me, but other than that, I just hope to get on a horse if I can.
But you still love the game, and you're renowned for your fitness. You're still tremendously fit.
Yes, although Seven Towers did try me out a bit last week, but I still feel very fit, and I mean, 36 isn't that old. I don't know. I mean, you'd like to keep going. I enjoy it. I still earn a living at it. And obviously, if there's a shortage of rides, it's forced upon you to retire, but I mean, I'll keep going certainly this season, and hopefully I'd like to think I could maybe ride next season.
And for many punters this afternoon, on obviously a curtailed afternoon, you ride the good thing of the day, Shrivar. But the first question Graham Goode raised this morning, no headgear on the horse.
Yes, obviously he's a winner on the flat with the visors on, and I wasn't so keen to have them on up at Edinburgh, and I thought they'd make him very keen, and fortunately, Edinburgh being a sharp track, they've gone a terrific gallop, and I have got him settled, and he's jumped nicely with them. So, I mean, really, we've got to try him out and see if he can do it without them. I think he is a winner on the flat without them as well. So, stop him, and it's just obviously over 2 miles over hurdles. He doesn't want to be doing quite so much as he maybe did up at Edinburgh.
Well, let's hope it's 997, and thanks for talking to us.
Thank you.
Now, racing at Catterick today will run 5 minutes late. This enables us to show you five live races. So the next race there will be off at around 2:05 instead of 2 o'clock. Of course, racing here at Lingfield has been abandoned, as has racing at Stratford as well. Now, with the abandonment of racing here at Lingfield and, of course, of the meeting here a few weeks ago, there's been much debate regarding the management of this all-weather surface. But one all-weather surface, which has survived the recent cold weather without hindering the preparation of horses, is at Newmarket, the Newmarket Gallops. Peter Amos is the managing director of Jockey Club Estates, which includes 2,800 acres of training grounds. And recently he spoke to Derek Thompson.
It's been like this for the past few weeks, -6 overnight. There is absolutely no way any horses could canter on this, never mind gallop. We're here at Newmarket, the big training centre, and amazingly, they've been cantering and gallop every day throughout the winter. Peter Amos is with me, the man who runs it. We've got horses coming up in the background. What's the secret, Peter?
Derek, I guess the secret is that over the years, we've invested pretty heavily in maintaining and managing the all-weather tracks we've got here. I would prefer to use the term artificial gallop rather than all-weather, simply because you know, all these tracks do behave differently as weather conditions change. But the second generation of artificial surfaces we use are very tolerant in terms of temperature fluctuation, and that's simply because of the way they're put together. The all-weathers we have here, and we've now got about 12 of them that are truly all-weather, and they're maintained in such a way as to make them usable in even the sort of freezing conditions we've experienced over the last week or so.
I mean, it is amazing here. These have been with us now for, what, 11, 12 years, these all-weather trains. Which one's the best? There's all different names for them, but which ones would you put at the top of the list?
Well, as far as our experience is concerned, we would suggest that the Polytracks or the surfaces that come out of that, as it were, stable, Protrack, and more recently we've installed three Visco rides here at Newmarket, and again that is really a variation on the sand theme, but it has mixed in with the sand a high density of elasticated fibre. That in turn is blended into the track and then Vaselined, and it minimises kickback, it minimises surface displacement, it rides consistently, and in cold weather like this it's really not affected. The polymers that used to be used in the old Equitracks were much more temperature sensitive. I think the other thing that you've got to bear in mind is we work very hard at creating a right and proper cushion riding surface so that the trainers can be confident that the tracks are going to ride consistently. And effectively you're creating a layered cake. You put a pad probably about an inch deep above the stone base, and then the layer above that is the cushion layer, and finally you've got the tilth on top that just makes it look nice. But in effect the material above the stone base is increasing in density as it goes down towards the pad, and that is, it's the cushion that really the horses feel. We feel the first inch and a half, 2 inches on the surface we walk on. The horses are probably feeling the effect of the surface, the subsurface as it were, from about 3 inches down.
Now, from frozen turf there, now let's take the hand off. The hand gets very cold. Look at this, this is absolutely beautiful. It's like sort of the most perfect compost you would get in a garden centre. This is the new, what's it called?
This is called Visco Ride, and you can see the fibre in the material. But essentially, it's silica sand mixed with elasticated fibre and then dressed in Vaseline.
It is cold. I mean, that is, it's freezing that.
Well, if the ambient air temperature at the moment is minus 3.5, this is bound to be a degree colder than that.
How deep does this go down? How deep sort of like this?
In total depth, about 9 inches. Yeah. But there'll be a pad of about an inch, and then this 5-6 inch layer of cushion with this loose finish on top. But the important thing is that there's bags of depth, and therefore cushion effect for the horses as they ride up here. And our brief effectively is to allow horses to be exercised on these tracks and to come off sound.
And what about this kickback? Let's try the kickback. All right, you kick the sand in my face. Now, just him. I know there's a few of you would like to do that. I'm going to close my eyes.
I'm trying to replicate what a hoof would be doing.
Right, I'm closing this.
So that's...
What happened?
I don't know whether you saw what happened there, but I mean, it literally shifted about perhaps half a minute.
Kick it in my face. It doesn't even reach me.
It doesn't actually get off the ground.
So,
and that's really the effect of the fibre holding the sand material, helped by the binder of the Vaseline binder that holds the whole surface together.
This is the future of, now I'm not going to say all-weather racing. How much does this cost? Is it very, very expensive?
Yes.
It is?
It is very, very expensive.
What are we talking about here for something like this?
If you relayed this 5-furlong, 4.5-metre wide track in Visco Ride, you'd be looking at probably spending £32,000 a furlong for that. Those
for this wide. So for a racetrack which is, say, 4 or 5 times wider than this, you're talking about £150,000 a furlong. You're talking over $1 million, aren't you?
You're talking, I mean, if I could do a fag packet calculation for any of the all-weather tracks, and I guess they'd be looking at £3-3.5 million to lay in a modern-day second-generation artificial surface.
Peter, I know you've been drafted in by Lingfield to have a look. You've been down there. What advice would you be giving to them about what to do?
Well, I'm still sort of putting a report together. It's, I mean, at the end of the day, that information at the moment anyway is confidential, and it will go to the Jockey Club Inspectorate, and they'll make a decision as to what advice they then put forward to the Lingfield management and Arena Leisure who own Lingfield. But I would be pretty confident that quite a lot could be done there to improve things. They've got a very good management team there, and I'm sure they'll get on top of the situation. From what I saw the other day, it's there's certainly huge enthusiasm to get it and keep it right.
Are we looking, though, at a new track at Lingfield?
I wouldn't have thought necessarily a new track, but I may be able to put forward some suggestions as to how the existing materials there could be put together as a more consistent and reliable surface.
Peter Amos, the managing director of the Jockey Club Estates. I'd like to have seen him put a little bit more effort when he was kicking up that sand.
I would take the shovel up.
I know. Well, were you impressed, though? I mean, that surface clearly has worked.
It's a perfect example. That's a relatively new surface, and nothing lasts forever. You know, when you put an all-weather surface down, and it's basically sand, it's because it's sand coated with a wax or different types of polymer put into it. And, you know, after a certain number of years, these things, they want taking up and they either recoat in or put in a new surface in. And, you know, that's what's, you know, needed here at Lingfield.
Yeah, this surface is, over 10 years old now. Mac, you've got a market mover.
Well, I hope you're all sitting at home, glass in hand, a bit of smoked salmon, wonderful company.
Leslie's at home, smiling away happily that she's not here with you.
No, well, I don't know about that. But we have a steamer of the day for you. The horse is the only horse seriously backed in the offices this morning in the 3 o'clock number 4 Chagrin. Now, it was 5-2 and 9-4 chances. Now put it on the course. 13-8 is the price against Chagrin. And in the 3:30 race, the Major, who is Barry Dennis's Bismarck, the horse that he believes will be sunk, the price against that is 5-4. So if you fancy backing the Major against Barry Dennis's Bismarck, 5-4, that's the price against the Major.
Now, Mac, there's been a slight change. Istabrat runs tomorrow in Arnhem. If you just put your champagne down for just a second.
Simon wants to know who Reen is as well.
What's the news on Istabrat?
Well, the news on Istabrat, the tote this morning went up the arm 11-8, generally an even money charge. Remember, big odds on it was earlier in the week. Some firms asking for 2-1 Istabrat to win his fourth champion hurdle. Even money, 11-8 it was with the tote, is now tips 11-10. They've taken the 11-8, it's now 11-10, going for his fourth Irish champion hurdle win tomorrow in a race where 8 favourites and 24 runnings have won it. So we really see if Istabrat can win his fourth Irish champion and his fourth champion. Even money now, 11-10 top price.
Now, our next race from Catterick coming up. This is the stanleybet.co.uk handicap hurdle. Over 2 miles, they'll jump 8 flights of hurdles. There are 6 runners, and we're likely to have a very short price favourite here. Jim McGrath's there.
Yeah, they're at the start, but we saw them earlier in the paddock. Let's spin through them for you. The weights are headed by Kevin Morgan's Commonwealth. Quite a useful gelding. Won early in the season at Kelso, second both starts since, but this is his first run since obtaining that placing on pretty firm ground, and presumably he's had a little bit of a problem. El Salida making his first appearance for Howard Johnson. He was fairly useful for Jimmy Fitzgerald last season, ran once for him, didn't show much, now joined Howard, a bit of an unknown quantity today, you'd think. Shrivar, a 4-year-old, earmarked for the Triumph Hurdle if he comes up to expectations over the next few weeks. Successful debut at Musselburgh last week, scoring impressively, but as Peter Niven has just told us, was too free in the headgear and doesn't wear it today. Serdal is quite a keen sort of horse. He's from a very much informed stable, that of John Mackey's, and he's fairly handicapped. He hasn't run since last March, and so likely to need this, and he's also unproven on the ground, but well handicapped if he's okay. Mr. Perry, basically just shown ordinary form over hurdles. He ran this course on January the 10th and he was pulled up lame. Presumably it was nothing serious, as he's turned out again fairly quickly. And then Squandermania, like Shrivar, successful last time out. This horse a winner at Boxing Day at Sedgefield. It looked a tidy little contest, but the form's sort of Chinese. 2 have run badly, 2 have won.
I can't remember the last time a Triumph Hurdle contender ran in an all-age handicap. Handicap is Shrivar, but they clearly think a lot about it. It's now a 3-1 on chance. They're lumping on the horse, and it was odds on, and he won his only race previously at Musselburgh, that I still call Edinburgh, of course. It's in 7-1 bar. That's Squandermania and Commonwealth, with 9-1 El Salida, 20-1 against Serdal, and a pony 25-1 against Mr. Perry. But this Shrivar, an extraordinary preparation for Cheltenham, a handicap taking on older horses.
Yeah, it's an interesting point from Matt, but this is a small field, and if he is a genuine Triumph horse, he ought to be able to pass this. Just picking up on John and Max's comments from our first race, Mary Reevely's Mille Freak, the basis of consensus, while no one disagrees with what John said about that it was held up and seemingly never really asked for a significant effort, one Northern race reader who's seen it runner several times described it as, his quotes, not mine, a right cow, and you have to think overall that huge yard like Mary Reevely's wouldn't be bothering playing around with a horse rated in the 60s. But anyway, if Alan Dempsey had made a little bit more effort, then the likes of John Frankham and John McCrittick wouldn't have been asking those questions. But officially, no inquiry. And incidentally, that first winner, Mutardi, there was no bid for him either. Shrivar, who represents the chairman of the BHB, Peter Saville, a useful horse in his own right on the flat, and clearly taken to the winter game. He did jump well against similarly inexperienced horses last week, but here in this race, where it's likely to be a muddling pace, be interesting to see if his jumping stands up. Here's Graham.
It'll be interesting to see if he tucks in behind and how well he settles. He pulled very hard last time up at Musselburgh, and Commonwealth can make the running and is so doing. That's a horse on the right with the noseband. Lady Smith in the green and white jacket. They're all over the first, and Shrivar jumped that one well, settled, and on a much more even keel. Well, don't speak too soon. In second place in the stripes is Serdal. In third is Squandermania. Got his tongue hanging out. Then on the left, we've got El Salida in the spots. On the inside, we have Mr. Perry. Of course, that doesn't seem to have a trip. He might even find this 2 miles a little bit too much for him, as they come down towards flight number 2, and it's Commonwealth with the advantage. He's over that safely. To in second place, Serdal, and then in third, Squandermania, Mr. Perry, the inside, Shrivar. Just getting a little bit keen now, isn't he, Shrivar? As they cross flight number 3, over which Commonwealth led. Serdal sits in second place, and Squandermania on the outside is third. And these 3 to the 4 over El Salida. Often held up in his races as dual winner, Sedgefield and Catterick. Over the course and distance, he's been successful. Mr. Perry, well, he's 5th of the 6. And the long odds on favourite in a handicap is 6 of 6 early doors. So, in a little bit of rain, they make their climb towards the back straight. Don't be deceived by the sunshine. There are a lot of black clouds in and around the vicinity. Catterick, and it's Commonwealth with the advantage. To in second place, Serdal, on the outside, Squandermania, and then we have El Salida, followed by Mr. Perry, as they come to the first flight in the back straight, and Shrivar still held up at the back. So they're levelling up down the far side then, and head towards flight number 4, over which Commonwealth led. Serdal just a little bit iffy. Mr. Perry's on the inside going well. Up on the outer goes Squandermania. Very wide on the track, El Salida. And the long odds on favourite is Shrivar. And that's in a share of, well, 4th place now, isn't it? So, one more flight of hurdles to jump on the back straight. And they're coming to it now, over which it was Commonwealth that led to Mr. Perry and Squandermania. And then swinging along nicely is El Salida. And Shrivar on the outside. The one they're leaving behind now is Serdal, finding it all a little bit too much. And exiting the back straight with Commonwealth at the head of affairs by about a half a length to Mr. Perry in second. And then El Salida, Tony Dobbin, is getting a bit closer. So too is Shrivar, this quartet pulling ahead of Squandermania, and Serdal is losing touch completely as they turn for home. Just 2 more flights of hurdles to jump. Would you be backing Shrivar at 3s on now? It's Commonwealth with the advantage to Mr. Perry of the striped sleeves. On the left in the white sleeves, that's El Salida. And he still hasn't moved a muscle, has Niv on Shrivar. Light blue sleeve jacket, Commonwealth. A.D. Smith gets a reminder as they come down towards the second from home, but El Salida coming stand side, Shrivar is on the right. This is the second from home, the three will be in the air together, and Shrivar is a faller! Would you believe it, when he came there absolutely cantering, he is covered in mud. It's El Salida with the advantage now to Commonwealth in second place. Horse and jockey appear to be okay. This is the final flight. El Salida with a 3-5 lead now over Commonwealth in second. Squandermania is through for third. And as they battle inside the last 150 yards, El Salida with the advantage here. A clear 1-2 over Commonwealth. And at the line, El Salida wins his third race. Second horse home is Commonwealth, third is Squandermania, and fourth is Mr. Perry. Fifth will be Serdell, and they're the only five finishers. The long odds on favourite. Day of misery possibly for Mary Reevely. Two races, two favourites, two never make the frame. But El Salida has, he's won this in the colours of Mr. David Fulton, now trained by Howard Johnson. Fitzy, Jimmy Fitzgerald had him last year. Second horse home is number one, Commonwealth, ridden by A.D. Smith, Tony Dobbin in the spotted jacket. A.D. Smith rode the second, Commonwealth. And the third horse home, that's number six, Squandermania. But oh my goodness me.
Can I call John up? Right, coming to two out, and Shrivar cantering over the two ahead of him. Just half a length down, and going so well. I think it'll be interesting to see what Johnny Frankham thinks. It looks like the horse has just snatched a little bit at the hurdle. They're just beginning to quicken at this point. They've only gone a hack round. He's jumped really well up to this point. Steps a bit at the hurdle. Takes quite a heavy fall. Commonwealth under top weight, beginning to tire. El Salida avoids Shrivar. And under Tony Dobbin, he's none too fluent himself at the last, but goes on to win. And there's the happiest sight of all after an incident like that. Shrivar doesn't look any the worse, and nor does Peter Niven. Johnny, what do you think?
Well, the bridle's broke. Horse looks okay. Glad to say Niv's fine too. But it was one of those falls, Jim, where, you know, the horse was just travelling too well. A little bit of indecision. If he'd just been going slightly worse, I'm sure he'd have picked hold of it, made the horse stand off. As it was, it just did nothing. And the horse did nothing, and that was it. But anyway, they live to fight another day.
Well, I was astonished before the race that Shrivar ran in the handicap. Inexperienced novice, it was returned, the 3-1 on favourite, people lumped it on, fell as you saw, leaving El Salida to win at 9-1 from Commonwealth at 8-1, and Squandermania, the 7-1 second favourite, was third. Win on the tote, £9.90, places £2.60 and £2, the exacta £61.50, the computer straight forecast £65.81, but it does seem an extraordinary decision. Shrivar, one run over hurdles, taking on older handicappers.
Well, it wasn't the greatest handicap in the world, and it was actually in many ways a good test, but he didn't pass it. Let's give credit to El Salida, who's got the race won now. Then, understandably, perhaps a little bit tired. The last, he just clouts it, loses momentum. But Commonwealth was a beaten horse. He's run a game race under top weight, and the pair of them forge clear. Tony Dobbin keeping his horse up to his work. We said this morning on the morning line, Howard Johnson's horse is running well after a quiet spell. A few run well last week, and there's another winner to the tally. So, Howard Johnson and Tony Dobbin, they're in action in our next two races on horses with good chances as well. We'll be seeing how they go after this break.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
To be a doctor. I was wondering how long it takes to become a doctor.
5 years undergraduate, 1 year clinical.
6 years.
5 years undergraduate, 1 year clinical.
6 years.
Sometimes a dream is worth investing in. Norwich Union helps millions of customers invest.
Mum, Dad, you know I said I wanted to be a doctor?
Yeah.
I really do.
Great.
Together we're stronger. Norwich Union.
Absent friends.
Nick and Emma.
So where exactly is it that they've gone?
Straight to the bottom of the property ladder, I think.
There's nothing you worry about, isn't it?
What I want to know is, what are they running away from?
Just Chardonnay for one.
What is this thing that they're actually opening?
Can of worms.
Let's face it, she'll be back as soon as she's run out of leg wax.
Well, I tell you, I'd go tomorrow.
You said that yesterday.
I need to sit down. I'm not feeling too well.
Steve?
Oh, God. Will somebody help?
So what if I get a heart attack? At least it's quick.
Hello, can you hear me? No respirations, no pulse.
You've got to die something, haven't you?
He's in VF. Charging to 200.
You always get a warning. It's like a yellow card, isn't it?
He's in VF. Stand clear.
It's just God's way of telling you to slow down. Heart attack? That's the last thing I'll get.
Don't be a victim of Britain's number one killer. Look after number one.
Some dreams are worth investing in. Together we're stronger. Norwich Union.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Welcome back. Legendary footballer Terry McDermott, one of the people associated with our last win at El Salida there. But much of the talk in the area here was, of course, the demise of the favourite there, Shrevar. You heard Johnny Franklin talking about the horse almost going too well for Peter Niven. Of course, you can school a horse all you like at home, but when you actually go flat out at racing pace, and they're beginning to race now, they've gone steadily beforehand. And as John said, he's just going too well. I can't do a lot with him. Leave it to him. And he just didn't get high enough. More or less stepped at it, as a lot of inexperienced horses do in that situation. And 3-1 on shot, bit the dust. Who says there's no such thing as a certainty? Well, we'll be hoping for an incident-free 2:30, but that is a novice handicap chase, the first chase of the afternoon. And, that's to come. Now more from Simon.
Yeah, I wonder if Shrevar's done any particular damage to his claims for the Triumph Hurdle at Cheltenham. Mackie, what's his price as a result of that?
Well, 25-1 with the tote. Victor Chandler and Ladbrokes, 25-1 in double carpet, 33-1 Coral and Hills. I don't think it's harmed its chances, but why put a horse against experienced handicappers?
I mean, that has to be nonsense.
It does not. It is not nonsense.
It was run. It had five horses to run against. It could have had 17 to run against in a novice hurdle. It was 3-1 on to win the race. It clearly had a very strong chance, and it was going to hack up.
It's by far the best horse in the race, but experienced handicappers you're taking on.
But it was inconsequential, the horses he was running against, surely.
Well, I'd say well placed. Horses either jump or they don't jump. Regardless, that does make a blind bit of difference whether, you know, they're running in novices or handicaps. This is a horse off the flat, travels well. It's not like he was being taken off the bridle. It was just a novice-y mistake. He'd have made it in a novice hurdle just the same as he made it in that one.
Now, you've ridden one or two more races than I have. Are you telling me never does an inexperienced horse is found out when taking on handicappers? You can't say that.
Hardly ever. You can take a novice chaser, run it straight in a handicap chaser. Either they know the job or they don't.
Well, I should think in a race as uncompetitive as that, it didn't make much difference. Actually, one punter at Catterick had £20,000 on to win eight on Shrevar. So he'll be one sick fellow after that horse's fall there. Now, one of the big racing stories of last year was the failure of the Metropolitan Police to secure a conviction at the end of a long inquiry into racehorse doping. The whole episode cast a long shadow over the integrity of British horse racing. Now, on a recent visit to the Jockey Club's headquarters at Portman Square, Big Mac spoke to the Jockey Club's public relations manager, John Maxey, about integrity and a range of other matters.
Portman Square, in the heart of London, the home of the Jockey Club, where the rules and regulations of racing are made and enforced, where reputations and careers can be enhanced or destroyed. Within these portals, decisions are made and campaigns launched that often divide the whole racing community. So, are they up to the job? That's what I intend to find out. And the first question for John Maxey, the public relations manager, is how much corruption does the Jockey Club believe exists within racing?
Cases of corruption in British racing are few and far between, thankfully. But that doesn't alter the fact that we actually believe the current situation we have now is vulnerable to criminal activity. And there are a number of areas we seek to address in that area.
Now, over the last 3 years, the public image of racing has been dominated by dawn swoops on jockeys, arrests, charges, court appearances, gruesome sensational headlines, yet no conviction. Does the Jockey Club accept any responsibility for the image debacle?
I think it's a difficult question to answer. So I don't think we are personally responsible for the situation whereby racing's integrity or the way that it's been splashed over the racing papers and the national papers. I don't think we should be held responsible for that.
No. You instituted the inquiries, you brought in the police, it's proved a total failure. Of course you're responsible. Why can't you apologise and say sorry?
Well, I think there are many things with regards to the whole process dating back to the investigation from when the dopings took place in 97 through to the conclusion of the doping trial, which with, if the benefit of hindsight, might have been done differently. But the fact remains that two horses were doped, so that someone had the means and the motivation to try and install a criminal act upon racing. Now, in those set of circumstances, we had no other option, once we'd established that, but to hand the matter over to the police for them to investigate. Now, there's a chain of events which gets unrolled by such a move, but we stand by the initial move to bring in the police, otherwise there would have been no way of bringing those responsible brought to justice. Now, the fact that the end result didn't result in convictions doesn't affect the fact that the right decision was, in the end, to bring in the police. What I think is important, and I can understand people being upset and a lot of people's lives have been affected and the end result is disappointing for racing. What is vital though is that we try and engineer racing and the law into a position whereby the chances of this ever happening again are much reduced. That's why we've gone to the gambling review and we've asked for a specialist police betting unit to be able to handle this in the event, hopefully it doesn't happen, but in the event of it happening again. We want changes to the criminal law to ensure that racing is better protected. It's not an offence to dope a racehorse at the moment. Were it to be, then it's possible that in the future it would be easier to get a conviction. We're also doing our own measures to decrease the chances of corruption getting into racing. So that I think what's vital is, whatever your views on how this situation resulted, that racing itself positions itself better, so there's less chance of anything happening like this in the future.
You thought racing was corrupt as far as certain individuals was concerned.
Well, a case of thinking racing was corrupt, we actually had two horses doped, and some people, I think, have forgotten this in the surrounding press attention which goes with the lack of a conviction and arrests which probably shouldn't have been made. I'd be quite happy to say that.
They shouldn't have been made. Evidence has proved that.
There were arrests made that shouldn't have been made, and I don't think I agree. There's no doubt about that. But at the beginning of the day, there were two horses that were doped. People were trying to take criminal acts to defraud the racing public. That's a heinous offence and needed to be tackled. Now, the outcome, as I've said before, was disappointing. But in many ways, the actions which led to that were the right ones.
Do you regret that certain members of the Jockey Club were crowing when the arrests were made and saying, we've got our men?
I don't think we ever said we've got our men, but that was how it may have been perceived now. As I said, I think if you were doing things with the benefit of hindsight, there'd be a lot of things maybe regarding this investigation which would be done differently. Unfortunately, that benefit of hindsight wasn't available back in 98.
Now, you've instituted the integrity review with a new code of conduct. It seems mainly directed at jockeys and bookmakers.
Well, we've got a chance now to start afresh with this, and we think that what we're trying to do is put down a benchmark for the future. And we don't believe that it is in racing's best interests for jockeys, those who are actually involved in the outcome of a race, to have close associations, certainly in public, with bookmakers, those responsible for laying the odds on the events in which those individuals are going to be competing in.
So you're trying to stop bookmakers speaking to jockeys, certainly on racecourses?
That's absolutely correct.
Are you being tougher on jockeys than you are on trainers?
I think we are being tougher on jockeys than we are on trainers. I think the jockeys are the ones who are in the position to directly affect the outcome of a race. They're the ones who steer the horses home and ride a horse out for its finish. So they are in the front line when it comes to affecting the outcome of a race. So it is stiffer on jockeys than on trainers.
Trainers can bet, jockeys can't. Is there any plan to prevent trainers from betting? They affect the outcome of a race, clearly.
They could affect the outcome of a race. I mean, it's been suggested that jockeys ought to be allowed to bet back their own horses. I don't think there's any doubt in my mind that a clear-cut rule on jockeys not betting is actually better for racing. Situation which could result in a jockey backing a 33-1 winner, which he rode, and a couple of other horses in the race got less than inspired rides from the riders, would lead to all sort of allegations of collusion, and it would not be healthy. Or if a jockey himself got into debt with his own betting, you'd have a situation I think you'd want to avoid. So it's much easier if jockeys are not allowed to bet full stop. Trainers historically have always been allowed to bet, and there are not any instances that I'm aware of whereby that ability to bet has been detrimental to the integrity of racing. You might ask the question, why are bookmakers allowed to own horses? And perhaps if you were starting afresh with a completely clean sheet, someone came up with this wild new idea of staging horse racing with betting, you might install different levels of restrictions on trainers betting, perhaps, or on bookmakers owning racehorses. But we're at a situation where both those two things exist, and there isn't evidence to suggest they shouldn't continue.
Now, Richard Evans in the Daily Telegraph reveals how the Human Rights Act, which came into force 3 months ago, will affect the way procedures are conducted. Now, Article 6 is the right to a fair trial, and Richard Evans writes that licensed people who come under the Jockey Club's jurisdiction, such as jockeys, trainers and owners, have a right to a fair and public hearing by an independent and impartial tribunal when their civil rights are being determined. How are you going to change your procedures because of the Human Rights Act?
Well, the Human Rights Act, European Human Rights Bill, came into effect last year. Several other sporting authorities are affected by it, and we've been liaising with those to see how each authority actually is going to be able to respond to it. Now, we are making some changes which will be announced in the coming weeks. One of the authorities we've worked closely actually with is the Football Association, who've actually already introduced their changes, and ours are going to very closely resemble those that they've put in place. It's going to be very difficult to know how human rights is going to work. The Home Office described it as an engine of uncertainty, and until the bill is in place and put to the test in the courts, it's almost impossible to gauge what will constitute a breach of human rights and what won't.
Why do the Jockey Club maintain this secrecy when people's careers and reputations are at stake?
I don't think it's a case of maintaining secrecy. It's trying to get the best result. And at the moment, the view is that by conducting the inquiries in private, that best result is achieved. I know you have your own views with regards to steward inquiries on racecourses.
It's another thing, why can't they be held in public? Why can't the television cameras, the radio and the press be involved in them? It's public money involved here. What we're getting is race results being altered, affecting hundreds of millions of pounds down the years, and yet it's all done in secret. Why not let the cameras in?
Well, I think there will be a time in the future, and maybe the not too distant future, when the press and television cameras do have access to steward inquiries.
When's that decision going to be
made?
Well,
I don't know. It's an area which has been discussed by the Jockey Club, and arguments pro and against it have been made and thoroughly debated by us. I think at the moment, British racing isn't ready for it. Other foreign countries, Australia...
We're not babies. British racing not ready for it.
Just give me a chance to finish and explain. Australia and South Africa do already have access and grant access to television cameras and the press. And I think there will come a time when British racing does do it. At the moment, our stewarding system and the steward inquiries that go on the race course are being handled by a stewarding system which has made significant improvements in recent years. Now, I have little doubt that I think the industry would not want that improvement jeopardised. They would rather that our inquiries were conducted quickly and correctly, and that the right decision was reached, rather than have the increased pressure of television and press access possibly jeopardising the outcome of an inquiry, which I think could be the outcome. And I don't think that would be in racing's interest. We want the decisions to be reached, the right decisions to be reached, quickly and correctly. Now, when we've reached a stage whereby we feel that the introduction of the press and the television may not necessarily affect that level of decision making, then that may be the time for that to happen. It's not going to quite happen just yet.
Now, the journalists like Sir Peter O'Sullivan, the noble Lord Oaksey, have been elected to the Jockey Club. I don't want to push myself forward, of course, but am I next?
That's not my decision, luckily.
I think he might be offering 50 to 1 and drifting about that last point. But I don't think it's been a particularly good week or a couple of weeks for the Jockey Club. Just this week, they've decided to have Charlie Edgerton and Josh Gifford, the two trainers involved in the horses that were doped during that inquiry, into Portman Square. And the chances are, according to the rules, that both trainers will be fined, even though everyone knows that they were not guilty. Matt, that is balmy, surely.
Yes, I fully agree with you, but there's no proof involved. You've got to have a fallback line, a line in the sand. If a horse is doped, the trainer is responsible for it. You've got to protect the punters. I agree. In this case, it does seem absolutely extraordinary, but somewhere you've got to say the trainer is responsible for his horse.
But surely this was a public relations disaster for the industry. They could easily have just turned a blind eye to this last matter. Okay, you could say rules are rules, but it was such a high-profile case, did so much damage to their standing, the club's standing, and to the industry as a whole. Why resurrect it?
I still hope the Jockey Club can find a way of not finding them, find a way of words of keeping the rule intact. Trainers are responsible for their horses, but in these two cases, not finding Charlie Edgerton or Josh Gifford.
And a mate of yours, Rod Simpson, he seems to have been made an example of in the
last
week.
Well, it's a similar sort of thing as we're talking about Charlie Edgerton and Josh Gifford. You know, they'd have been better off just keeping quiet about it. I think the whole case was probably, they were right to involve the police, but I think the police probably mishandled it just through ignorance of the way that racing is run, you know, from a lot of what I've read about it. But you see, the Jockey Club are in a wonderful position. They've been talking about tapping jockeys' phones, maybe not tapping their phones, but having access to their telephone calls. When a race is run, you've got any number of runners, 15, they're all there. It's like the police never know where there's going to be a burglary. They don't know whether it's going to be in this street, that street. If there's going to be a burglary on the race course, you know it's going to be in the 2 o'clock at Catterick, or it's going to be the 2:30 at Lingfield. So you just got to watch it. They're all potential thieves. And if you think somebody's been had their hand in their pocket, there's the place to go and interview them there and then. You want to see the horse as it pulls up and see the jockeys. The jockey blowing is the horse blowing. Don't give them time to go home and then have them in. And, you know, I think that they're just losing sight of, you know, what they're after.
One of the big problems is the Jockey Club, how they're perceived by jockeys themselves. Now, Roger Buffum was head of security, Christopher Foster, behind all the arrests and everything, they've lost the confidence of the jockeys and the whole industry. Buffum and Foster should go. While they are there, the Jockey Club lose credibility with people within the industry.
Mm. Well, it will be interesting to see how those certain restrictions on jockeys, particularly their relationship with other members of the racing industry, how workable they are going to prove in the months to come. Anyway, back to Catterick now. Our next race is the 2:30. Jim's got some details.
Well, they're certainly working hard down there. All sorts of things are posing, and we'll be back for more chat later on. But our next race at Catterick is certainly one of the weaker heats run in the on Channel 4 this season. But it's quite a tricky little fare, quite an interesting one. The Stanley Bet Novices Handicap Chase over 2 miles. The weight's headed by Candy 4. Let's get the full list of runners and riders.
They missed the first one. Well, the runners are down at the start, and just having a look at that caption there. There are 12 fences. They actually jumped one on the spur for this 2 mile start, and the horses are arriving down there now. If you get a chance to have a look at a close-up of number 6, Bob's Buster, have a look at the horse's ears. It's stuffed with cotton wool. Candy 4, 10-1 chance, Brian Harding. Stonehill, 4-1, Tony Dobbin. Damon's Choice, 10-1, ridden by Derek Byrne. Lerpak Legend, 7-2, joint favourite. Alan Dempsey rides. Then number 5, Ollie's Boy, 16-1, Mark Bradburn. Bob's Buster, 10-1, Kenny Johnson. Trinity Boy, 7-1, Henry Oliver. Timopore Hill, the other 7-2, joint favourite, A.D. Smith. That's number 8, Timopore Hill. Number 9, then, is Little Warsaw, 7-1, and Robert Walford claims a £5 allowance on this horse. It's the charity bet today.
So, some of them have ability, and the weights, as I said, headed by Candy 4, New Zealand bred gelding. We looked at him in the paddock early on. He's a nice stamp of horse, a chestnut. Got his mark in this race from running 3 times over hurdles. You run off the same mark in a novice chase. Interesting to see how he goes. Stonehill is a horse who had ability over hurdles, then had a bit of an injury, time off. He's shown an aptitude for chasing, but he is a bit headstrong. If he settles under Tony Dobbin, definite chance. Damien's Choice is a bit of a tricky character. He made his debut over fences at the last Catterick meeting, and he never got into the race. He usually wears a visor, didn't that day, but it's back on this afternoon. Lerpak legend has quite a bit of ability, but he is a tricky ride. You've got to finesse him, bring him late. He doesn't find much off the bridle, but there's no doubt he's got something of a chance. Ollie's boy is hard to recommend in any shape or form. Completing will be an achievement for him because he's not the best of jumpers by some means. Bob's Buster is a bit of a nervy horse. He pulls very hard. He ran, or appeared to run well, at Doncaster last time. Might have been a bit of a muddling heat, but didn't flatter him, you couldn't rule him out. Trinity Boy has come a fair way to take part in this. This is his chasing debut. He showed a bit of ability in bumpers, but hasn't done yet over hurdles. We'll see over fences, but he is well treated on the potential he showed in bumpers. Of the runners with form in this type of event, Timapore Hill is pretty solid. Under an attacking ride from A.D. Smith, he ran really well at the last meeting here, and a similar effort should see him thereabouts. Little Warsaw was one place behind him that day and opposes on terms £1 worse, but it was only his second start. He hasn't had much racing and there may be a little bit of improvement in him. He is the selection of our Monkey Business contender. Around 9-1, his selection.
Timapore Hill, trained by Malcolm Jefferson, who had Winchester, who won the opening race, been back down to 11-4 favourites, and they have flip-flopped on the course with Lerpak Legend out to 4-1, trained by Mary Reevely, ridden by Alan Dempsey, and of course they've had the failures with Mill Afrique and Shriver in the early races, not the day so far for them. Stonehill's on the shoulders at 9-2 with 7-1 against Trinity Boy. Some money for Trinity Boy in from 9-1, and also for Damien's Choice, 107, 14-1 early doors into 8-1, 9 Little Wurzel, 10 Bob Buster and 12 Candy Four.
So they race away, and Damien's Choice was a little bit slow to stride at the back of those green sleeves. On the extreme left we got Bob's Buster, a horse that used to be trained by John Wharton and pulls very hard early on. That's on the extreme left. On the extreme right with the yellow cap is Timapore Hill. They're at the first fence now, hold your breath. These are all novices, and the faller there was Trinity Boy. He's out of the race already. So it's Bob's Buster with the advantage as they quickly arrive at fence number two. Horse and jockey associated with that fall in the first are okay. All over the second. Now the third fence here is an open ditch. This will concentrate the mind. The dark blue colours, Candy Four, is coming for a view of the front two and three in the air together there, with the red cap Little Warsaw is prominent. So they come down towards fence number four. It's Bob's Buster, Candy Four, and on the inside, Timapore Hill. Eddie Smith rides his northern track so very well. Stonehill is back in fourth place and touchdown ahead of Little Walford, who's five. Ollie's Boy is in sixth place, and then we've got Lerpak Legend, and the back marker is Damien's Choice, and that's the order as they come up past the enclosures with a circuit to go. And it's Timapore Hill on the inside, the dark colours of Candy Four, and Bob's Buster on the outer with that long raking stride. They're clear of Stonehill, running off a mark of 81. He was run off a mark of 81 the other day up at Musselburgh, and hasn't been reassessed for that run. And these are behind, sort of following these, are Little Wurzel, and then Ollie's Boy, and then Lerpak Legend, who's in the yellow jacket of the Mary Reevely Racing Club. Quite a few of that happy band of pilgrims are here, and the back marker is Damien's Choice as they level up into the back straight, where still these three vie for the lead. Bob's Buster on the outside of Candy Four and Timapore Hill, and then Stonehill in front of the white jacket with the red cap Little Warsaw, the red with the blue sleeves Ollie's Boy at the first in the back straight, which the leaders clear with Elan. The next one is a plain fence, and as they come into it, Stonehill has come into just spearhead for the lead there, but Timapore Hill on the inside with it, and out wide is Candy Four, the New Zealand horse. Back in fourth place now is Bob's Buster as he takes that one, jumped it well. Little Warsaw is in fifth place, and they're clear of Lerpak Legend in the yellow jacket, starred sleeves, in front of Damien's Choice as they take the next one on the far side. And it's Stonehill on the outside of Timapore Hill and Candy Four, they're 1, 2, and 3. Then getting closer now, the red cap Little Warsaw, Bob's Buster on the outer. Damien's Choice, he was very quiet on that, wasn't he, Derek Byrne, early on. getting closer now, but Stonehill heads for home. Could it be a day for Howard Johnson? Lots of money for Chagrin, already a winner this afternoon with El Salida, and his Stonehill here has the edge. To Candy Four in second, Bob's Buster in third, Red Capital Warsaw, Robert Wolford's getting closer on that one, and then we have Damien's Choice. They're 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Now Lurpak Legend, yellow colours, so given the leaders a lot of start, down the straight they come, 3 to jump, and it's Stonehill with the advantage and a good leap too. To in second place, Candy Four, then Little Warsaw still getting closer into second place and closing on Stonehill as they come down towards the second from home. He stood off a long way on Stonehill, got away with it. Lurpak Legend looks held now, back in a one pace fifth, but it's Stonehill with the advantage as they come down towards the 12th and final fence in this novices handicap chase. It's Stonehill with the edge here to Little Warsaw, who hasn't given up yet in second place, under pressure trying to close. Candy Four and Bob's Buster and Lurpak Legend legless. Damien's Choice follows that, but Little Warsaw trying to press Stonehill as they race up towards the line. There's not going to be much in it as the line comes. Stonehill just holding on under Tony Dobbin. A double for him this afternoon. His 69th winner of the season, Stonehill has won. Little Warsaw is second, Candy Four is third, Bob's Buster comes home four, Damien's Choice five, Lurpak Legend continues the misery for Mary, well beaten, and then we have Tim and Paul Hill in front of Ollie's Boy. The result then of this, the Stanley Beck Co.dot UK Novices Handicap Chase, it's gone to horse number two. This is Stonehill, the colours of the Braw Partnership. Johnson's saddled another winner. We'll try to give you some indication this morning that the stable were returning to form, and big hopes on the big plunge horse in our next race, Chagrin. Can Tony Dobbin, who rides that horse, make it three from three? It's two from two so far. He's the winner. Second horse home is Little Warsaw, and third, number one, Candy Four.
Well, once again, it's great to have John Franken with us this afternoon. Interesting to hear his thoughts here, because Stonehill thought he had a decent chance this morning, but he's been given a tremendous ride by Tony Dobbin. Admittedly, the horse has been very bold for him up the home straight, but Tony maximised his chance, got him jumping early on. The second's done absolutely nothing wrong under an excellent ride too from his amateur rider, and there wasn't much in it all the way, but just getting everything spot on seemed to make the difference. If Tony had erred slightly or the horse had let him down, I don't think they'd have held on, but as it is, they're all out, responds gamely to firm handling, but responding all the time, and it's another winner for Tony Dobbin, who continues a tremendous run of success, really he's had since coming back from a serious shoulder injury late autumn.
A Stanley Bet Co UK double for Howard Johnson and Tony Dobbin. 54-1 double they've had after El Salida in the previous race on the shoulders. 9-2. Stonehill has returned. Little Warsaw second at 10-1. Candy Four was third at 12-1. They sent Timmerpoor Hill off, the 11-4 favourite. And the tote wins £6, 5-1 on the tote. Places £2, £1.70 and £3.90. Exacta £53.90. Computer Straight Forecast £44.50. All nine ran 54-1 double. And coming up now is the steamer of the day for Howard Johnson and Tony Dobbin. That's Chagrin. And after that double, Chagrin is possibly going to be even shorter than the 13-8 it's been backed into already from 5-2.
Big reception for the winner here, another success for Howard Johnson, and of course Tony Dobbin with plenty of supporters here. Great big lop-eared horse, isn't he? But he stuck on bravely, and no sign of jumping errors, but that couldn't be said about chasing debutant Trinity Boy under Henry Oliver. Young Henry Oliver got no further than the first. Let's look at this again, towards the outside, and just didn't appear to do very much at all. Hit the top of the fence, crumpled over, and his chances went west at the first. But Henry Oliver unscathed, and just explaining to Mrs. Margaret Turner his side of things. Horse is always keen, running down to the first at Catterick, just slightly downhill into the fence. Nothing wrong with the fences, as you see the other eight jumped it perfectly. As I said earlier, they were hardly the best horses either, but just a novice mistake, and a new experience for horses, and he didn't cope. This fella did.
and he ought to stay a little bit further in time too. Today was 2 miles. Hoping very much that you'll stay with us a little longer too. We're off for a quick break.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Priceline lets you name your own price for airline tickets. Unfortunately, in America, a few of the 8 million people who paid less assumed they got less. Once their offers were accepted, they became slightly irrational and were sometimes discovered bewildered and alone.
Come on down, please.
On the world's leading airlines, this sort of behavior is completely unnecessary. It's also embarrassing and, frankly, rather cheap. Priceline would like to avoid such incidents occurring in the UK. Priceline. Just name your own price.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Well, welcome back. A double so far for Howard Johnson, who saddles hot favourite Chagrin in our 3 o'clock. He's just behind me talking to the press corps. We've got umpteen questions to ask him. Hopefully he'll come over. A word with us. Sorry, he'll talk to us in a moment. He just finished off with the press and take the presentation, so we can't bring you that. We thought we might. Let's take a check on additional fixtures, because we did miss one off this morning when we recapped them. This Thursday, there's an extra one at Catterick. I say we missed it off. We actually, last week, included the first batch of extra fixtures that the Jockey Club instigated, and the one we showed this morning had all the new ones, and Catterick obviously wasn't part of that, but... we're happy to oblige. There's an extra fixture at Catterick this Thursday, and then February the 8th we're at Stratford. Friday, February 16th there's Kelso, and Wetherby on Saturday the 17th, 24th Uttoxeter, Saturday March 3rd there's Southall, and Monday March 5th we've got Market Race.
And while we're waiting for Howard Johnson to arrive at Jim's side, your chance to enter today's picture puzzle. You Horrible Little Something, and it may have been scheduled to run here at Lingfield. 09068 99 11 44, 09068 99 11 44, that's the number to ring.
And Seamus Durack in action in our next race, but his mum Tish has also been really busy because she's organising a charity evening in Ireland. And if you live in the Cahare, County Tipperary area, get across to the Kilcoran House. That's on the 3rd of February. Should be a really good night. Tony McCoy's going, Richard Johnson, and plenty of the other top jockeys. And it's in aid of Aware, which is a charity for depression. So, Tish, Seamus's mum been busy.
Mm. They won't be very busy at Barbary Castle tomorrow for the Owners and Riders Association point-to-point there. That meeting at Barbary Castle has been cancelled. Mac.
Well, I think there's some days of racing you never forget. Of all the days we go to the great winners that you rode, of course, Grace, on the superb commentaries that you gave, Langwid. But I remember De Lamy winning at Gulfstream, fantastic in the Breeders' Cup after Swain the year before for Frankie Dettori. Not so much the horse, but for the man. And news in the Racing Post today that De Lamy's first foal has been produced. It's by myself, and a great story there must be behind that. But first of all, I think you can never forget De Lamy winning the Breeders' Cup turf at Gulfstream for Frankie Dettori.
set down for the drive. Butch Boy defending the championship, and he is a tenacious champion. Here comes Delaney, unleashing an explosive rally, and Royal Anthem lengthening his stride. But Delaney runs by them all, and Delaney will win it going away. Delaney by three on the wire.
A jubilant, ecstatic Frankie Dettori. The man had proved himself. He had shown America that what a jockey that we know that he is, and no longer can they go back to Swain and that terrible ride that he admitted he gave Swain. But the interesting thing on this new foal is by myself, and myself was runner-up in the Queen Mary at Royal Ascot and also runner-up to Lamtara in Lamtara's only race as a juvenile at Newbury. Lamtara, of course, went on to win the Derby, the King George and the Ark, and as a three-year-old trained by Neil Graham and owned by Lady Tavistock, it was winner of the Nell Gwyn at Newmarket. And people will say greatest jockey, they're seeing the picture there of its first foal. It isn't a grey. Now the foal looks exactly similar to her mother. The foal looks like just like myself. What is the chance it become a grey? What's the position
it
on
might,
that?
It's very unlikely that it'll turn grey. Sometimes they'll be born chestnut and turn grey, but by and large chestnut's a more dominant gene than grey. But Delami's mum, Deltawa, she was a grey. Her mum, Demana, she was a grey. But I doubt whether this one will turn that colour.
And it's the fourth foal of that myself. She's other foals. Gaith was the first foal, and Gaith won the Convivial at York and was third in the Champagne at Doncaster. Other foals by Zephonic and Green Desert. She's going back to Green Desert, but it's actually a great story. Delamy, if his genes can be transmitted to other horses, I think he was a fantastic horse, a great racehorse. The races that he won over various distances, the French 2000 Guineas, the 10 furlong races, and that Breeders' Cup. A fantastic horse, a great horse to breed from, Delamy.
I just wonder if he's actually going to stamp his stock at all, Delamy, looking at that.
Yeah, an interesting
there.
Point to see what the next 39 look like.
Don't they 300 odd per year, the way they're...
Don't they say the dam is more predominant in colour? Is that a theory?
Colour-wise, maybe, yeah. Yeah, but, you know, he might get a few grey ones along the line. Certainly an amazing racehorse.
Oh, absolutely wonderful.
I can't believe he's got foals on the ground already. Seemed like it was yesterday, that
just
race.
Just yesterday, yeah.
I remember NBC in America couldn't believe Delamy. No, we'd gone through, we'd never won at Gulfstream. There'd been two Breeders' Cup before at Gulfstream. No European winners. We'd gone through another lot of failures we had. And this race, the one or two before the end, and Delamy came up. Oh, it was a magic moment. The turf is wonderful. Everyday racing is wonderful, something special. But there, you'll never forget Delamy winning at Gulfstream.
Great memories. Anything else in the papers that has caught your eye, Matt?
Well, it's fascinating. I'm talking about Delamy. Well, this is certainly will not apply to Delamy here. This is in the Racing Post. A United States trainer has been banned for 6 months and fined $2,000 after unusual drugs finding. He's a gelding, so why should I give him Viagra? So he's accused of giving the beast Viagra. It seems a fair point, as the Racing Post says. Now, this is a very interesting piece. You remember this story we've got of this greengrocer up in the north who's keeping to pounds and ounces, absolutely right, rather than these kilos and grams, this European nonsense that's overwhelming. Brussels is killing us is Brussels, and it's coming in racing. Could it happen in racing as well? Well, the Star says here that if that greengrocer gets done for weighing out apples in pounds instead of kilos, what chance will racing's clerk of the scales have? Greyhound racing, I think, has never recovered from the metres from the yards. The Derby is now 480 metres rather than 525 yards it used to be at White City, and I've had a letter, luckily no address on it, so I'm going to reply here to Mr. T. Williams, who says, how long before some crank or nutter comes along and tells us to use metric units and measurements? Will we be dragged into compulsory metrification? I hope not, Jockey Club and BHB. And finally, he asks here, what is the metric measurement for a short head, a neck and a length? So I don't pray God, and we don't have all that. They have noses, don't they, and all that sort of thing abroad.
I wonder if that case with the greengrocer might set a precedent, whether the Department of Transport will then change all the road signs around the country
into
kilometres.
America
would they like to do that, I wonder?
Well,
that might cost a few quid.
About petrol is quite interesting. I looked at the pump the other day, and you know it converts litres into gallons. And then it had all the prices of the litres, and then it had the price of litre. It only went up to 63p, and now, of course, it's gone way beyond that. That was, you know, in no time at all.
You can't say, but America, they're great for statistics. In golf, always statistics the whole time. In the National Football League, in American football, always statistics, always based on yardage. So what they would do if they had to go, but of course, America too sensible, unlike us, with this European nonsense here. And also, I did like this piece in The Express talking about syndicates. And a lot of people want to get involved. You might want to get involved in owning a racehorse or being part of owner of a racehorse, I would like to put one proposition to you, that any horse that's syndicated, couldn't they put down underneath it its last selling price, or what it was bought for, either out of a seller or a claimer or at the sales or at auction, whatever it is, so that everyone could know the last price it was sold at. Any reason why not?
No reason why not at all, but you know, it's just business. Like when you sell a car, I don't suppose you tell anybody what you paid for your car in the first time round, but...
I think it would help the honesty of the whole game, wouldn't it?
Yeah, no, but if you're that keen, it's very easy for you to find out. You know, all you got to do is phone the sales company.
Yeah, very fair point.
Oh, it was a good suggestion, nevertheless. Jim's back at Catterick, and he's got the winning jockey in the last race, Tony Dobbins, with him.
Yeah, Tony's here now. That was a solid effort from the horse, because he was a bit guessy at Musselburgh the time before, and you must have been, for all you won, a little bit apprehensive setting out.
Well, not really. I mean...
Come on, be honest.
Well, he made a silly mistake at Musselburgh, and he gave Graham no chance of staying with him. And to be fair to him, one or two around here, he took one or two chances at the first in the straight. He let fly with me a little bit, you know. But he learned, you know, he's getting it together. He learned. It's all experience for him.
He certainly battled on game, didn't he?
Yeah. The thing about this fella, he'll want further. And he'd want good ground, and so like you're running on a sharp track on a trip that's inadequate to him, and he wants better ground.
And Mr. Johnson's horses, Howard Johnson's horses, have been very flat, and then all of a sudden they just seem to have come to life.
Well, that's it, and it's the same old saying, when the trainer's horses start coming well, stick with them, you know.
But obviously, Tony, most people expected you to be riding Barton today, which is a Haydock you would have been if it had been on. What news of him?
Mr. Easterby says he's very well. Obviously, it's very unfortunate that he couldn't run today, but I think there's talk of him running at Cheltenham next Saturday. So the Cleve hurdle's down there. So, I mean, he's absolutely bouncing, to tell me. So, looking forward to him very much.
And just one more reflection before we look forward. Skipper's Klook undoubtedly has tremendous ability, but I know working with John last week, who was down at Warwick, he just felt the horse had no respect for his hurdles. You were the man on board. What would you say to that?
Obviously, he's got an argument saying that because he did miss the last two and one down the back, but I promise you, it's only because he's in front on his own. He's just looking around him. He's very green. He wants better ground for me. I'm not saying he wants proper good, fast ground or anything, but that day at Newcastle was very tacky and very holding. He was out in front, and when he got to the front, he looked around him over them last two hurdles, and that's why he missed them like that. The horse has got loads of ability, and I'm sure that when he takes on a better race, that he'll jump a lot better. We only ever school him over fences at home, that Mr. Lungo has told the public that. And he jumps great, you know, he's just very green and backward. And I tell you, there's a lot more improvement to come in this horse. He's a very exciting prospect.
Well, so we've mentioned Barton and Skipper Sloot, they're your stars. Chagrin is not a star, but there's a lot of money for him this morning, and he must have a sound chance in what looks an ordinary race coming up.
If he runs to his form, even here the last day, he would be very capable of winning it, but... He did have a hard race, that's one thing I will say. He did have a hard race here the last day, and it's only 10 days ago, but like I say, Mr. Johnson's horses are very well.
And you're on board.
Thank you.
Good luck. So Tony and I briefly swap places. He's gone off to get ready, and while he gets ready, we'll take a little break.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Intelligent Finance is the unique new bank from the Halifax. It works by connecting the money you have with the money you borrow in any product combination that suits you to make you better off. It's easy to move your mortgage to Intelligent Finance. And if you connect it with an Intelligent Finance current account, you could pay no interest on part of your mortgage. Just call 0845 600 4343 or apply online at if.com. This is one of the many ways you could be better off with Intelligent Finance, just by connecting the money you have with the money you borrow. So if you want to pay no interest on part of your mortgage, call Intelligent Finance now on 0845 600 4343. Or apply online at if.com. Making the right connections could make you better off.
Absent friends.
Absent friends.
Nick and Emma.
So where exactly is it that they've gone?
Straight to the bottom of the property ladder, I think.
What I want to know is, what are they running away from?
A decent Chardonnay for one.
What is this thing that they're actually opening?
Can of worms.
Let's face it, she'll be back as soon as she's run out of leg wax.
glass, darling. No, glass.
Well, I tell you, I'd go tomorrow.
You said that yesterday.
You've awakened to the true power of e-business. Do you have the software to manage it? If not, consider this your wake-up call. Our software manages more e-businesses than anyone else on Earth. Hello, tomorrow. We are Computer Associates, the software that manages e-business.
Eggcard is now giving you 0% APR on balance transfers. This is meaning that you can put your credit card balances on Eggcard and pay no interest for 6 months. Nice. You like, huh? Then apply at egg.com. Please, baby, come to us.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Welcome back, and the runners filing out onto the course for the Leaming Handicap Chase over 3 miles, 1 furlong and a few yards. Basically, they've got 2.5 circuits of the track to go, and there's some old favourites in here. As I said earlier, none of our races are of a particularly strong quality, but this is definitely competitive. You can make a case out for a few of them, despite the fact that Chagrin is a strong favourite. Let's check out the details. I will actually spin through the horses for you, and the weights are headed by Victoria's Boy. Basically, Hunter Chaser, who's come into handicaps, has been running fairly well and definitely has a squeak of sorts. Running Moss on his toes won this one over this course and distance last time in dramatic fashion, having dropped back and looked likely to finish tailed off on the home turn. Stayed on well to win close home and stays really well. That's his forte. Morden Boy, one of two representing John Joe O'Neill, won on good to firm ground last time out. That was 3 or 4 months ago. Has something to prove here under these conditions. Chagrin, a useful stayer, jumps well, ran well over course and distance last time. Major player, as the betting implies. Ivory Coaster wouldn't be without a chance, but he's not the most reliable jumpers. Pulled up on Boxing Day, and quite honestly has got something to prove this afternoon. Waterfont was fourth when Chagrin was second at the last meeting here. He's got a £6 pull for that. On his day he's got a bit of ability, but he's not the best of jumpers either. Kidderside lad has his problems. In fairness, he's got ability, but he is an 11-year-old. He has broken blood vessels and he's hard to fancy. Movie Man never showed much over hurdles when in his younger days, and since going over fences has actually shown jumping problems and really little sign of ability. Hot Red is another outsider on all known form. He's not the best of jumpers either, and we can only wish Michael Norton and Betty Broad good luck. And then finally Sniper, a 9-year-old. He definitely had some form this horse at one time, but he too shown a tendency to have problems. In his case it's a breathing problem, and that's the reason he appears to have lost his form.
Well, we have the steamer of the day here, this Chagrin, who was 5-2 and 9-4 in the offices this morning, opened 11-8 on the course, is now Earol 6-4. The 5-1 against Morden Boy, 11-2 Hunting Moss, Victoria's Boy is 13-2, 10-1 bar, that's Waterfront and Movie Man, 25-1 bar those, but Chagrin for Howard Johnson and Tony Dobbin going for a treble. But great, as we were looking at the horses there going round the paddock, as a jockey, how much do you look at the other horses, your opposition, when you're in the paddock?
I think you take a certain amount of notice, certainly if something else is fancied. You'll always have a look to see whether it looks a bit on the fat side, or maybe it's on edge or sweating something a little bit out of character. But by and large, you just, you know, pay more attention to the horse that you're riding.
Would you change your plans of riding if you saw something in the paddock?
No, you should know your horse. I mean, provide you either done your homework, you've ridden it before, so you know, right, okay, all this horse does is stay, or maybe it pulls hard and it needs to be settled, and so that's your main priority. Or maybe it's got a little bit of speed, or maybe it just wants holding up and, you know, until as late as possible. You know, you should know your animal. That's
Chagrin,
the priority.
6-4, Baka or Alea?
Oh, God,
what do you
do? Got to lay it. You know, they've been shouting it all day long. Harrod Johnson, he's had two winners. You're bound to be thinking to yourself, well, can he have three? You know, it's unlikely. You know, no, sit and lay it.
Go on, Shagreen.
Go with Barry Dennis.
No, I hope Shagreen goes and wins. Steamer of the day, show you up, great one. Go on, Shagreen.
I would lay it. It's my charity.
Well, they, I hope you.
It's had it, I'm afraid. Jim's got John Joe's wife, Jackie O'Neill, with him.
Yes, bit of glamour here on a cold afternoon at Catterick. You've got a little bit of a tan.
Yes, we've been away on holiday, so we had a few days away. It was lovely.
And I know before anybody's thinking, oh, glamorous life, you all work very hard. But John's not too good, that's why you're here today.
Yes, he had a bit of a flu 2 weeks before Christmas and picked up a virus. We're away in Barbados and he didn't seem to recover fully, but no, he's slowly getting better, just taking time. Thank you, Jim.
And two runners. Morden Boy, I think the first question punters would ask Jackie is, will he go on the ground?
John just said, you know, he really could do with better ground, same as Waterfront, better, you know, conditions for them, both would suit them, but they're doing well to race here at all today, so we'll take what we're given.
And word about legal right, you are obviously delighted with him, we won just before Christmas. He's an invalid as well, is he okay at the moment?
Not great, no, he's every day he's sort of crippled, to be honest with you, but, you know, we're just treading water carefully and hopefully, you know, we can sort of get him to Cheltenham, but it's not that far away now, but I close my eyes when I go and see him in the mornings.
Actually, I mean, without being rude, one or two punters might say that when Waterfont's jumping fences might close his eyes, because he has shown a tendency to make the odd mistake.
Yes, he has, and hopefully, you know, the blinkers, it just makes him concentrate that little bit more.
Well, let's hope he concentrates well today, and we wish you success with them both. Thanks for talking to us.
That's great. Thank you, Jim. Thank you.
Well, the steamer of the day, Shagreen, has been backed again 11-8. They've done 5-2 and 9-4. Now 11-8 favourite, Morden Boy. And I really hope Shagreen goes and wins and sends most of us to pay for our champagne and our smoked salmon sandwiches. Morden Boy is a 5-1 chance, with also 5-1 running Moss. 6-1 against Victoria's Boy. Little support for Waterfront at 8-1. 10 Movie Man. 25-1 bar those.
So they're lined up. Stretch 3 miles. They've got 19 fences to jump. And Waterfront just turning around on the left. Victoria's Boy, Hunter Winner on the extreme left of the picture as well. That's it. And away they go on this marathon trip. Now then, Shagreen lining up on the inside. And it's a short run towards the first. The favourites on the inside in those purple and white colours. At the first, he's safely over, as are the rest, although the back marker is pot red as they make their way towards fence number two. It's Sniper in the red jacket that leads. The black and white colours, Running Moss, sometimes finds a flat spot in racing and may lose his prominent position. He's about a circuit to go and then finish with a flourish. At least that's what he did when he won here last time. Morden Boy in the hoops. Andy Thornton rides on the 40 winner mark with a white cap tucked in behind them. But Shagreen moving through on the inside of Sniper, with Running Moss out wide, having jumped three. A couple of lengths behind these, Waterfonts, Lincoln Runner on the outside in fourth, and then Victoria's Boy on the inner in five, followed through by Ivory Coaster and Morden Boy and Get Excited Lad. The back marker is Pot Red, Movie Man in the last group as well, as they swing past the stands and out into the country. Shagreen cost 60-odd thousand, didn't he, when he was bought from the Dunlop Yard. Completely fulfilled potential. Howard Johnson's trainer. Tide has certainly changed for that yard. Crooked County Durham. He'd only had six winners prior to the start of racing today, and now he's looking for a hat trick on the only days racing on turf. Sniper though leads as they level up down the back straight. Sniper with the edge here. To in second place, Shagreen. And then we have Running Moss in third, and Victoria's Boy in four. And after these comes Morden Boy. Waterfont is a little bit down the pack, racing wide. The next plain one, and there's no change up front. Ivory Coaster now is plumb last. Get Excited Lad moves up midfield. Movie Man making a bit of a move to go into a share of fifth place as they take the ditching their stride. The next one is a plain fence, fence number 7. Sniper with the advantage to Chagreed in second place, and then running Mossy in third, keeping with them, and then Morden Boy in those hoops out wide. We have Waterfont, so the O'Neill horses on the outside of the track looking for the better ground. Had a walk down back straight earlier on this afternoon, and the ground in very good order indeed down that side of the track. And it's Chagreen, the 11-8 chance, running Moss 5-1, Morden Boy 5-1, 6-1 bar. Tony Domin scraping the paint, running the rail. He's giving up the inside to no one on Chagreen. Going for his fourth win, Chagreen. But it's Sniper who has the edge here. Certainly up in grade today, but with ears pricked. Has the edge here to Whitesleeves running Moss, Brian Story riding. Popping over that, and they're jumping, as you would expect experienced chasers to do on this good to soft ground. So they come to this open ditch over which running Moss led, Morden Boy a little bit slow, and at the light blue colours, Pot Red, that was a little bit low and slow there. Ivory Coaster might just pass that as they come into fence number 11. This will be the last on the next lap. Oh, one or two slight ricks there on the outside. Waterfont nearly sent Seamus Durack into orbit, but he kept the partnership intact. So they come up past us, and Sniper with the edge here, making good use of his lightweight. Circuit to go, Chagreen. Is Tony just being going to give him a reminder as they come past, I suppose, possibly to keep him in contention. Then running Moss is third, and then on the outside we've got Waterfont, and then Victoria's Boy in the pink jacket on the inside. JP McNamara riding, just starting to shovel the coal on that one. Morden Boy's being pushed along. Out wide we've got Movie Man, not in the picture yet. Then Kiddock Side Lad, and the back marker is Ivory Coaster as they turn down the back straight. And at this stage, Jim, would you be on to play or lay this Chagreen?
Oh, the way he's going at the moment, you wouldn't be very keen. He did go in snatches last time, but not quite as badly as this. And there are one or two going well behind, notably JP's Morden Boy. JP McManus is in the green and orange. That's travelled nicely just off the pace for Andy Thornton. But there's still plenty in with chances, Graham.
None more so than Movie Man, who has made a strong move up on the outside. Chagreen with the edge here to Sniper. Then that number 9 on the outside, that's Movie Man. Look at the green and white hoops of Morden Boy. Mr. Brack tomorrow, Morden Boy today. And that, John Frankham, was a very good jump.
Yeah, he got onto the outside, onto a bit of better ground, Andrew Thornton. He's gone up there just for the one ride. But Chagreen... Tony Dobbins had him in the right place the whole time, because he does run in snatches. Obviously, I'd say if you had to nail him down, he was a little bit further, but he's got him jumping into a good rhythm. If he gets beaten, it won't be because he hasn't been in the right place or not given a chance.
Saving ground, but they're all starting to pile on the pressure. Movie Man in the centre of on the outside, Morden Boy on the inner Chagreen. Then we've got Waterfont, so could Jonjo have a 1-2 in this race as they continue the journey down the far side? Just crossing the fence there was Ivory Coaster, but that's not going to play a prominent role in proceedings. That running Moss rather lost his pitch going down the back straight. Not in the picture at the moment as Movie Man starts to make ground, but he's coming back into contention. He's got half a mile to go. It'll be a big ask for running Moss, that is, but Movie Man into the lead, a winner of only one race. Dennis Grattan riding, two in second place, Morden Boy. I think we can say bye-bye to Chagreen. Down the straight they come, and this is the third from home. It's Movie Man from Morden Boy, 1 and 2. Then we've got Waterfont in third place. Looking well down the pack, Sniper is going to be pulled up. This is the second from home, over which Movie Man is kicked into it. He's getting a little bit weary. Can Morden Boy find more? There goes Waterfont. That's running Moss, white sleeve jacket. Believe it or not, don't give up on him yet. They've still got a furlong and a half to go. Can the front three come back to running Moss? This is the final fence. It's Movie Man, very weary, very much out to his right. Morden Boy followed. Back in third place is Waterfont. And then comes running Moss, who, funnily enough, is equally leg weary. Chagreen has faded like a damp squib, but this Movie Man is keeping up the gallop as they race inside the last 50 yards. It's going to be Movie Man who wins for the Beaumont Yard. Movie Man is the winner. Waterfont comes through to beat Morden Boy, so the O'Neill camp second and third, very clear of running Moss. A big break then to Ivory Coaster after Ivory Coaster, Victoria's Boy, then, only then, Chagreen, who faded dramatically down the home straight. Some of the others have pulled up, and so the result then, of this Leaming Handicap chase. It's gone to Movie Man in the colours of Mrs. E. Dixon, trained by Peter Beaumont and ridden by Dennis Grattan. Second horse home was number six, that was Waterfont. Seamus Durack rode that, also in blue and red colours, incidentally. And the third horse home was number three, Morden Boy. O'Neill claims second and third price. Peter Beaumont trains the winner of this 3-mile marathon at Catterick today.
Well, sticky old ground, and they finished tired, as I think a lot of us expected. Chagrin ran a stinker, dropped away on the home turn, and I must say, when they turned out of the back straight, I thought Morden Boy was going to win, but once they turned for home, it was a different story. Movie Man, who basically jumped soundly the whole way today, he couldn't knock his jumping this time, apart from maybe the last, which he ran down a bit, but that was understandable. That was tired, and it's a question here, can he last out? Going into it, Dennis Grattan sees a stride, kicks him, and although he pitches a little on landing, he's never in danger of coming down. Waterfont's beginning to stay on again, and as Graham called, old Running Moss, who got outpaced, runs on too. Morden Boy briefly looks as though he might get back to him going to the last as this horse runs away to his right, but that was the right thing to do. Dennis Grattan let him go, and he popped it safely, getting close, fiddle it in effect, and then ran on gamely on the run-in. Waterfont stays on well from the last, and it's a near thing in the end for the runner-up spot, but the Beaumont Yard had a setback early in the week with the news that Bobby Grant had been injured, and today they've got a little something to cheer about.
Movie Man, bang in your picture, as you would expect, return the 10-1 winner. Movie Man, a great result for the bookmakers, at Movie Man going and winning at 10-1. The surprise result was a 16-1 chance on some bookmakers' tissues before the race, but returned at 10s. Waterfont was runner-up at 8-1 with Morden Boy third, the 5-1 chance. They backed Chagrin down to 11-8 favourite. Never looked like winning the Chagrin once it was passed, going down the far side. And the wind tote, £9.50, so some support on the tote for that. Returns 8.5-1, places £2.20, £2.30 and £2.10. The exacta, £54.70. Computer straight forecast, £77.37, non-runner number 8, 10 ran, and greatest jockey, that Morden Boy's action, that's what took your eye, extraordinary action, splaying its legs out.
Turning in for him, had a leg in every county, looks like it wants, you know, the ground couldn't be soft enough for it. But no, fair play to the winner, they've done well with that horse because he's changed stables and he's been disappointing a couple of times, but he galloped right the way to the line. I wouldn't be surprised to see him win again.
I think Tony Dobbin really gave us the clue, that Chagrin, hard race a few days ago, he warned. Always listen, whenever jockeys are interviewed or trainers, listen for the negatives. If they say something's wrong, fancy it, go well, but... And Tony Dobbin did mark our card. That's what they were worried about, and that was right.
We were saying, weren't we, it was Sod's Law that Howard Johnson should have those two winners, and then the one that was really fancied and back today doesn't run any sort of race.
Just going to tell you, he would have completed 129-1 treble for Johnson and Dobbin. We worked it out not to be.
Well, Movie Man was the star up at Catterick for our latest race there. Coming up, a look back at some racing from Leopardstown last Sunday, and one more race to come as well at Catterick this afternoon at 3:30. Stay with us.
Sport on 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
I need to sit down. I'm not feeling too well.
Steve? Oh, God. Is somebody help?
So what if I get a heart attack? At least it's quick.
Hello, can you hear me? No respirations, no pulse.
Well, you've got to die something, haven't you?
He's in VF, charging to 200.
You always get a warning. It's like a yellow card, isn't it?
He's in VF. Stand clear.
It's just God's way of telling you to slow down. Heart attack? That's the last thing I'll get.
Don't be a victim of Britain's number one killer. Look after number one.
We
With its unique control blade independent rear suspension, the Ford Focus gives you ultimate control. And Ford's clear price policy means you can drive one away from just £10,495.
Do I worry?
We all worry about our health. But Norwich Union's Fair and Square Health Plan lets you choose to go private or use the NHS and get £250 a night money back. So relax. For healthcare, call Norwich Union on 0800 66 7799. Norwich Union. Together we're stronger.
How far can you get on 5p? Well, call this number and ask NTL how you can talk to friends and family in Australia, Canada, France and Germany, Hong Kong, New Zealand, and America for just 5p a minute. Around the world, day or night, for just 5p a minute. There must be someone I know out there.
Call free on 0500 500 500 and ask about our international call option.
Sport on 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
Welcome back to Lingfield. We're having a good time here, despite the meeting being called off here at Lingfield today. Of course, we've got Catterick.
Yeah, but he's
as well.
Saying shepherd's pie is a £1.90 job. I go to the Ivy and have a tenner of a shepherd's pie. I think it's a terrific value.
Do you think you could just keep your mind on the racing?
Oh, today, sorry.
By the way, is there any chance of a glass of champagne?
Not for you, certainly know, not.
It would be nice to be
certainly
offered.
Not, certainly not Langwood.
I was just going to say you have some, but there's none left.
Yeah. So, from an inebriated McCrory.
No.
We're going to take a look back to last weekend. There was some excellent racing at Leopardstown last Sunday. Of course, there's a very big race there tomorrow when Istabrat runs in the AIG Europe Champion Hurdle. But last Sunday, there were several big races, including the Pierce Hurdle, which was has been known under various guises in the past, including the Labrook and the Irish Sweeps. Grinkov was the favourite of the 24 runners this year under Charlie Swan at 11-2. Spokesman at 9-1. Massalarian at 10-1, moving on up at 12s, and amongst those on 14-1 was the sole English raider, the Philip Hobbs trained Rooster Booster, ridden by Richard Johnson. Let's see what happened.
But it still laws to be headed. Kapok is there on the outside. Grinkoff is there too. Ricardo improves on the inner. Then Trifena. And they're followed by Shiny Bay as they come to the second last now. Laws and Kapok. These two from Grinkoff. Trifena, Ricardo just behind them in the gold colours. Then comes the Gatherer. And we've lost one there at the second last. As they swing for home, they want to jump. And Grinkoff goes on. Ricardo's in second. They're followed by Trifena, the Gatherer, the outside. Then Laws. Massalari from the back of the field. Rooster Booster also trying to get into it. They come to the last. Grinkoff chased by Ricardo on the near side. These two from Massalarian. Rooster Booster and the Gatherer. The final flight. Grinkoff the favourite. Jumps up in front. Ricardo's in second. They're clear of Rooster Booster, putting in a run in third as they race into the closing stages. Grinkoff from Ricardo. Rooster Booster, Massalarian and the Gatherer as they race up to the line. It's Grinkoff and Charlie Swan. He's going to win this race at long last. Grinkoff wins it for Pat Hughes and Charlie Swan. Ricardo second. The English challenger. Rooster Booster finishes well. Third,
Massalarian 4. Tony O'Hare there alluding to the fact that was Charlie Swan's first win in that prestigious race on Grinkoff, who I thought was pretty impressive and may now go for the Supreme Novices Hurdle at Cheltenham.
But he was a novice taking on handicappers. Now, we're going on before.
Doesn't it?
Because only one run that other creature had had earlier. This had plenty of runs in novices. Well, makes that Ned Kelly form look absolutely terrific. Three or four winners have come out of that race. Ned Kelly's going to be one of the Irish bankers at Cheltenham after Grinkoff there. But I still always worry a novice. But it was the inexperience of that Shrivar. That was the problem of that one run. Now, Grinkoff knew more about it.
Shrivar's just like Grinkoff. Really good flat form. He was fifth in the Cambridgeshire, Grinkoff. You know, Shrivar. You know, decent horse, you know, was running in good races, and they travel well, so they're always able to just quicken up and jump well. But Rooster Booster, you know, Tote Grohl Trophy.
Great run.
He ran a very good race, Rooster Booster. It was, looked a bit unlucky, stopped in his run up the
street. No, not unlucky against
Grinkoff. He wouldn't have beaten the winner.
No, never beaten the winner.
Well, the course at Newbury suit him better.
It was only beaten four or five lengths. It might have been close. Anyway, At least the drink's not talking, as far as I'm concerned.
I beg your pardon. What are you hinting at? Language.
Anyway, another big race last weekend at Leopard Stand. It was a very good novice chase. This was the Fitzpatrick Hotel Group Novices Chase and featured the chasing debut of Rosmoff, who was a particularly decent hurdler last season. Conor O'Dwyer in the saddle, 7-2 on favourite, up against Misty Moments at 9-2, Idiot Star at 12s, and Highland Leader at 14s, Bucks Venture, the outsider, at 33-1. The commentator once again was Tony O'Hare.
Rosmoff travelling well, the favourite now, the big nose band, in fourth place, just behind Misty Moments. They come down to the second last, and it's Idiot Star from Bucks Venture. Misty Moments, Rosmoff jumps up, just stumbles on landing there, pecked, and didn't lose that much ground. As they swing in now with one to jump, and travelling easily the best of the quartet, Rosmoff, but he still has to pass Idiot Star and Bucks Venture. Misty Moments ridden along in fourth, and Highland Leader has lost contact as they come down towards the final fence now. Hard at work, John Cullen on the right, Ken Whelan in the centre, Conor O'Dwyer travelling confidently on Rosmoff as they come to the final fence now. Rosmoff comes into it, jumps up alongside Idiot Star, and they're followed by Bucks Venture in third as they race into the closing stages. Rosmoff just that little genuflection at the second last, but he's having a little more than a schooling session here, and he's going to hack up, going away, sprinting away in good style. Fine first appearance over fences, an easy task, but he's done it very nicely indeed. Rosmoff the winner by 8-9 lengths or so. Idiot Star is second, Bucks Venture is third, Misty Moments is fourth, and Highland Leader fifth and last.
Just a slightly anxious moment at the second last, slight genuflection there on landing, but he looked a good horse there, didn't he?
I think Nicky Henderson was watching that closely. I think him and Bacchanal are the two horses to be looking out for in the Sun Alliance come Cheltenham.
But do you think Sun Alliance and not Arkle for that horse, Ross?
Difficult. They didn't go any gallop there, and I shouldn't think Tony Martin's any the wiser. Hopefully he will be after tomorrow.
Well, that's going to be a greater test for the horse. Yeah. I mean, it has to be said, although he won easily there, he didn't beat him.
Never came off the bridle. You know, when you go to Cheltenham, you're going to be winging along there. You've got to have had plenty of experience under your belt.
Well, he ran a very solid race at the festival last year. I think Rosmoff is a horse to keep on your mind for the festival.
Well, that's obvious,
March.
Having seen that race, you fool. What a stupid statement that is.
That is the drink talking.
Yeah, it is.
That's
another
obvious,
irrational outburst.
I shouldn't let him in the ivy tonight, do you?
Well, he won't pass the breathalyzer, will he?
Anyway, driving, thank goodness.
Anyway, Jim is waiting with great patience at Catterick because he's got Brian Harding, who rides Peradventure in the next race.
Yeah, I'm sure the viewers would much rather listen to Brian Harding than John McCrick. Brian, some punters at home will have looked at form this morning, they'll have gone back through last season and say, Peradventure, on last season's form, if he can jump fences, he's a good thing.
Yeah, on last season's form, like you say, if he can jump fences, you say he should be a good thing. He hasn't really shown, his couple of runs over, he hasn't really shown at all. We put blinkers on him and he hasn't ran the same. Full stop, he hasn't shown, you know, bad all ground when he ran, and it probably wouldn't have helped him, and it'll probably be a bit soft from today, but on his hurdle form you'd say he's a different, a lot better than these.
And how has he schooled over fences since you turned him to jump?
Yeah, he's schooled alright, yeah. He's not the biggest horse in the world, but he's jumped him well enough, you know, so we're half hoping just to switch to fences might just, you know, might help him.
And of the front two, the Major and Tashreef, second and fourth here last time, which would you prefer?
Well, I'd nearly prefer Mrs. Rivley's horse, the other horse.
The Major?
Yeah, he just seems to take a bit of winning with Tashreef, you know, but yeah, I would prefer the Major.
Well, good luck. We maybe talk to you after if you win.
Thank you.
Brian Harding with a big chance in the next race at Catterick. One more race to take a look at from Leopardstown last Sunday. This was the Leopardstown Handicap Chase. Possible Grand National contender or two in this. It was a very open race, despite the fact there were just eight runners. Shannon Gale, Tyndarius, Cockhardy Diamond and Montana Glen, all co-favourites at 9-2. Miko's Dream, ran in the National last year at 5-1 under Ruby Walsh. Puget Blue at 6-1. Nazem Roadmakers at 12s. And Magical Approach, the 14-1 outsider.
And it's the blinkered Newsom Roadmakers, the leader. From the top weight, Miko's Dream in second. Puget Blues, three. Tyndarius closing on the outside. Shannon Gale trying to get back into it. They run the turn into the straight. Newsom Roadmakers for Herb Stanley and Michael Cunningham. In the lead from Miko's Dream. Puget Blue, the green and orange. Tyndarius around the outside. Shannon Gale's under pressure. They turn now to face the final fence. And it's Newsom Roadmakers, the leader. From Miko's Dream on the rails in the red and white colours. Puget Blue and Tyndarius just behind them. And then Shannon Gale. They come to the final.
final fence. Mick O'Stream, the top weight, coming there under Ruby Walsh to John, but just in front of Newsom Roadmakers. Shannon Gales behind them with Puget Blue, and as they race into the closing stages, it's Mick O'Stream, Newsom Roadmakers, Puget Blue on the near side with Tindarius, and then Shannon Gale, Mick O'Stream, Newsom Roadmakers fighting back. A good finish to this handicap, and Mick O'Stream, driven out by Ruby Walsh, defies top weight and wins the Pierce Leopardstown Chase. Shannon Gale's up for second, Puget Blue possibly just third. Close enough with Newsom Roadmakers, Tindarius fifth.
Pretty grueling finish there, and some hard riding on the run-in as well. Mikko's Dream looks a really tough, honest horse,
lovely,
doesn't he?
Yeah, tough as old boots. I mean, he was struggling from away out there, just keeps his head down, keeps grinding away, jumping. And even though he was tired, still came up for Ruby at the last.
Do you think, just watching that finish, that the Irish jocks are a little freer with the whip?
Oh, I think they are, yeah. Their rules aren't quite as tight over there. And it's like anything else, you know, you'll play within the rules.
John, national horse perhaps?
Well, a possibly national horse, we're talking about the whip. It was the Irish jockeys back, Drumlagan, and horses like that in the 80s in your time, who brought in very so totally unacceptable what they were doing with the whip. When you see races like that, I just think racing can do without that. I think Ruby Walsh is a terrific rider. And Ted Walsh, I remember Ted Walsh when he was riding his dad. He was a man, if the money was down, you were on Ted. He was a terrific rider with the money down. But a much more stylish Ruby, isn't he, than his father was?
He's a much improved jockey, I mean, and rightly so, you know, champion jockey over there and a lot of experience. And, you know, he's a big, lazy type of horse, you know, and if you're allowed over there to give him half a dozen, you know, whacks with a whip, then and you think, you know, it's a big race. You know?
Just tell us one thing, why is it so many Irish jockeys over here? Hardly any English or British jockeys. They're all Irish on the flat and over jumps. Why is that?
Well, they have a lot of experience as young lads, you know, they're nearly all riding from a young age. They're flapping, you know, doing pony racing, so they come over here. And, you know, it's something that they're looking forward to from a young age.
I wonder, actually, if a ban of hunting in this country will actually reduce further the opportunities for young riders to come through over here.
I think there's two ways of saying that. Some people say that they'll be more concentrated on the point-to-points. They'll be at the established point-to-point courses. Some farmers won't allow them to go on. But people still want to ride. They want to get their daughters and their sons out riding, the gymkhanas and the pony clubs. Point-to-points will go on. And I want hunting to continue. But even if hunting is finally abolished, and I hope it's not, if it is, I think still point-to-points will flourish.
Yeah, I should think so. Mikko's Dream last year got as far as the first fence in the National. Perhaps he'll get a bit further come the spring. Now, look what we caught at Lingfield a bit earlier this morning.
A fox, there you are.
Possibly endangered species.
Wonderful. Well, it would be an endangered species. If hunting is abolished, you will not see that in this country in 10 years' time.
Now,
the species will be abolished, like hares. There'll be no hares or foxes.
Right, it's time to take a break now. We've got another race at Catterick coming up, the 3:30. We'll be back soon.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Absent friends.
Absent friends.
Nick and Emma.
So where exactly is it that they've gone?
Straight to the bottom of the property ladder, I think.
What I want to know is, what are they running away from?
A decent Chardonnay for one.
What is this thing that they're actually opening?
Can of worm.
Let's face it, she'll be back as soon as she's run out of leg wax.
Well, I tell you, I'd go tomorrow.
You said that yesterday.
Which miniskirted property developer is Britain's richest woman? In tomorrow's Mail on Sunday, discover which mobile phone tycoon broke his neck go-karting but still made a billion. Learn why 23 of Britain's richest own their own football clubs. Who are Britain's richest 300? The Rich Report 2001. Only in tomorrow's Mail on Sunday.
You don't have to live in a town or a city to enjoy great value phone calls. Call this number and you can find out how NTL have simplified the world of telephone charges. For instance, the long-distance rates mean you can now phone anywhere in the UK.
For the same price as a local call.
Their 3-2-1 price structure is dead easy to understand. Calls cost a penny a minute at weekends, 2p a minute in the evenings, and 3p a minute during the day. And remember,
You don't have to be a cable customer to enjoy it all. Plus, with NCL's international option, you can enjoy great rates when you call someone abroad. So, you can talk until the cows come home, without worrying about the cost. Call NCL free on 0500 500 500. NCL, the complete communications company.
Sport on 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
Well, back here at Catterick, that lake in the middle of the track, that's where the irrigation comes for when they need to water the course, is partly frozen. That's how lucky we are to have racing here this afternoon. Since the sun came out and the sky cleared, in effect, it's got colder. And we've got black-headed gulls, and I believe our expert, our ornithologist, told us we've also got a podget on the lake, but I haven't actually got that in writing, so you'll hopefully just have to trust me, as they say. Well, they're on the way to the start for our last race, the 2 mile, 3 furlong Beedale Novices Chase. We looked at the runners earlier on. 15 fences to jump, a field of 7. Let's spin through them for you. Number one is Hancock, who has yet to show any real aptitude for jumping fences and was brought back over hurdles when last seen out. Hard to fancy. Over the Beck at one time was a promising horse. He was quite a good novice hurdler, but he hasn't gone on since. He didn't show much here over fences the other day. Peradventure, as Brian Harding has just summarised for you, a little bit disappointing over hurdles this time. A good horse last year, and if he takes to fences, it'll be hard to beat in this, but it is an if. Shermie reappeared after a lengthy absence due to injury at Sedgefield in Novice Chase on Boxing Day and was fading when falling 4 out. Tashreef, an 11-year-old, has shown a fair bit of ability. He's a little bit of a tricky ride, but he does jump soundly and he'll take advantage of any flaws in the favourite's makeup. He was 2 places behind the Major over this course and distance at the last meeting here on January the 10th. The Major jumped well that day, and this looked a good opportunity for him. What's the Buzz, stepping back in distance after running over 3 miles last time out, jumped pretty badly on his reappearance, and like one or two others here, hard to hold out much hope for him.
Mare de Bed odds on this, the Major. Opened up even money. It was 5-4 on the bookmakers' course. Tissue now, they're asking for 11-8 on for Mary Reevely. She's had 3 runners today, and including her defeats, Miller Freak at 11-4, Shriver 3-1 on. Are you prepared to bet 11-8 on Barry Dennis's Bismarck? The great bookie believes at the morning line this morning the horse to lay. 11-4 Tashreef. Some support for that to beat the Major. 6 bar.
So it's 15 fences to jump, and the Major in the check jacket on the outside. What's the Buzz, the leader at the first, which the leaders take safely, and Hancock has moved through on the inside to take up the running now. So it's Hancock with the edge to What's the Buzz in second, the Major in third, and Tashreef, who can... Oh, goodness gracious me, that Hancock took a bit of a jump at that one. That's the open ditch. Shermie is last with one, and Peradventure trails as they head down towards... The next, a plain fence, the Major through into second place, but it's Hancock that has the edge. One more fence to take on the far side, with Hancock leading to the Major, and Tashreef on the outside with the black cap as they pop over that. And then What's the Buzz, who was up there early, sort of losing his pitch now a little bit. Over the Beck is making ground through on the inner. These are the leaders, and Peradventure, Mickey Hammond. Before racing, he tells me that the horse has missed a couple of schooling sessions that he would have liked to have had under his belt prior to running in this novice chase, but weather precluded that. So they start the turn in, and it's Hancock that chose the way to over the Beck, whizzing through on the inside. Useful at this trip, 2.5 miles, 15 to jump. Then the Major through into third. Tashreef is on the extreme left of the picture with the black cap, the spotted pinks of What's the Buzz showing up as they come to this next one, which is an open ditch, over which it was Hancock that led. Peradventure, a little bit novicey at the back marker there. Shermie well down the pack. Fence number 7 now, over which it's Hancock with over the Beck, the inside, 1 and 2. And then comes the Major in third place with Tashreef in fourth, winning in his 55th, 56th race. 11-year-old novice, 3-1. About four lengths clear then of Shermie, and what's the buzz, finding it all a bit much. Horses labouring a little bit in sixth place, but a length of the good over Peradventure, who's the back marker, and they're sweated up quite a bit on what is quite a fresh day. So they make their way towards the back straight and fence number eight on this oval track at Catterick. Five fences to jump in the back straight, three in the home. And it's still Hancock that has the advantage. To Tashreef, the outside of the major, and over the beck. And this quartet are going further clear of Shermie, who's in fifth. And the other two, Peradventure, has now passed What's the Buzz. It's getting all a bit much for What's the Buzz. But it's Hancock and the Tom Siddle for the James Heatherton yard that leads. And he was keen to lead. Tashreef in second place, over the beck on the inner. The odds on favourite. The major is on the outside in third place, lobbing along. But not that fluent at that one. And it's Hancock with the edge. But the major, Jim, moving up on the outside now. See how he jumps his plain one.
Yeah, well, he jumped that big. But he appears to have plenty of running in him. But don't discount Hancock. He's jumped well in front so far. On the other hand, Tashreef doesn't seem to be firing today.
He certainly took off good stride and a half early, did Hancock, and he is jumping well. Tashreef the inside, the major lobbing along on the outer, on the extreme left of the picture, looking for that better ground. Oh, but he very nearly went there. Oh my goodness. Back in fourth place is Shermie. So it's Hancock with the edge here to the major in the major on the outside of Tashreef, who's jumping well through on the inside. And they begin the turn out of the back straight, and Hancock, almost too exuberant to that fence there, has lost the initiative now to Tashreef. But the major on the outside, and these horses have crossed swords before. Victory went to the major, but Tashreef has got the inner as they begin the descent towards the home run. They've gone clear of Hancock and then Shermie. A big, big break to over the beck. What's the Buzz and Peradventure are continuing, but are well tailed off. So it's a head-to-head between the two market leaders. The major on the outside of Tashreef. They're one and two, still two to jump though. And then behind these into third place is Hancock. Shermie is fourth. Peradventure has been pulled up. Here we are two out. The major, oh, he's guessed it, and he is gone. So misery for Mary Reeve as the major departs. That leaves Tashreef a long way clear, coming down towards the final fence. And it's Tashreef, but he's still got to jump it to win. Comes to it, kicks into it, takes it well. He's a long, long way clear of Hancock, is in second place. Then coming home third, two very weary horses over the beck and Shermie. But as they race up towards the line, it's Tashreef. John Crowley looking round, he can't believe how far he is. Tell you that Alan Dempsey's on his feet. But this victory is Tashreef's in this Belknell Novices Chase, winning, easing down. Second horse home is Hancock, and third is over the beck. Shermie is going to continue and pick up fourth place. And there is some money for that. The other two are pulled up. So, a day that heralded so bold for Mary Reevely at the start of play has been one of absolute disasters. Two fancied horses, odds on favourites, both fallers. But our winner here is Tashreef. Here he is on the right. There goes a major. Chancey down the far side. Hancock's back in third. Second horse home is indeed Hancock. Third is number two over the beck. But here we are, Tashreef being ridden along here. Here comes the major on the left. Goes for the top of it. Brushes it. Clumsy. Careless. But victory goes to Tashreef.
Yeah, Mary Reevely, one of her horse boxes with one runner in broke down. I bet she wished the one with the other six in broke down too. But you got to jump to win, the oldest cliche in the book, and it may be overused. Tashreef has survived and due winner. But the major had made a couple of mistakes down the far side. Hancock's in the lead here, the major tracking him. Hancock makes a mistake, but so too did the major. He'd already got away with one. Just stumbled on landing there. In fairness, that wasn't a bad mistake, but he stumbled on landing. And whether he just lost his confidence a little bit after that is debatable, because he certainly didn't go with any fluency from there on in.
A nightmare for Mary Reveley after Miller, Freak and Shriver beaten the Major, a 5-4 on favourite unseated rider, that the Major. Tashreef, the winner, 11-4, clear second favourite, beats Hancock 66-1 over the Beck third at 10-1. And greatest jockey, I've got to ask you this, should Tony Dobbin have fallen off the Major?
Well, it was Alan Dempsey, wasn't it?
Alan Dempsey.
Yeah, I mean, he did well to pick the horse up off the floor early on, but there he'd be annoyed with himself. You know, it was an open goal and then sliced it over to the corner post, just coming down here. What can a jockey do? It's exactly the same as Shriver. Going too well, all he's got to do is get over it, does nothing, and just falls off. He'll not be pleased with that at all. To be fair, you know, he's had a really good season and he's normally a good jockey, and that's the sort of thing it can happen.
Is there anything a jockey could have done there?
Loads of things. I mean, 99 out of 100 wouldn't have fallen off of it. But, you know, for some reason, you just lose concentration, you're travelling well, and it happens.
Was he being too cautious, do you think? Seeing the race, letting the horse pop.
It's exactly the same as Shriver. All they wanted to do was get over the hurdle, get over the fence, because they know they've got to win the race, and you end up not doing anything positively. You don't pull him in the mouth and say, right, come back here. And he'll be annoyed with himself, and I hope he doesn't let it play on his mind at all, because,
What's he thinking?
Well, he's just obviously, he's disappointed with himself more than anything else. He's a really good lad. Bright, rides a good race, rides really well. It was just a rare lapse of concentration.
So, delighted Harvey Smith representing his wife here this afternoon. Tough little horse that, deserved a win. Won a hurdle race last season over the same distance, been knocking at the door in novice chases, and he's finally obliged. And we'll be obliging you in a couple of minutes.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
The search for intelligent life. That is my life. Waiting for something to respond to me. But the answer is only miles, not light years away. The new Toyota Avensis with satellite navigation and a responsive VVTi engine. So, if it's out there, what am I doing here?
The new Toyota Avensis.
Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams, Yeats.
Peace, perfect peace in this dark world of sin. Bickersteth.
Oh, sleep, it is a gentle thing, loved from pole to pole. Coleridge. To sleep, perchance to dream. Shakespeare.
Book early to avoid disappointment. Branson.
Investment trusts. Of course. Not catchy catch. Experts investing for me in the stock market. End of tax year. Investment trust ISA.
Dad?
One day, you'll thank me.
This is important. Call this number. Come on.
Hello, Sarah. Is this poster right? It's the Royal Bank of Scotland credit card. It says 3.9% APR, but that seems ridiculous. Fixed till January 2002, right. So, could I get one? Well, great. All I need now is the telephone number. 0800 16 16 16.
To apply for a credit card with the Royal Bank of Scotland at just 3.9% APR, call now on 0800 16 16 16.
I believe the best-selling topical painkiller for backache, rheumatic and muscular pain, and common arthritic conditions. I believe is now also available in a new maximum strength gel. Available only from pharmacies, I believe maximum strength. Pain relief without pills.
Otex Eardrops disperse earwax and can avoid syringing. Ask your pharmacist for the UK's number one selling eardrops, Otex.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Welcome back. Well, if you've been playing the short-priced horses this afternoon, it's probably a day you want to forget. But whether you like it or not, it's time to laugh or cry again as we look back, beginning with the 12:55.
Coming down towards the final flight now as they do so, it's going to be Winchester with the advantage and made a lot of the running. Ashgar having his first run over hurdles, got a little bit low there and nods on landing and really does have legs of jelly there. The very weary horse, Winchester, the fitter one today, stays on the better, and Winchester up towards the line. Tom Siddle rides a winner, Malcolm Jefferson trains. Ashgar a battling brave second, but not good enough on the day. There's only one more flight of hurdles to be jumped in this selling race, and it's Mutardi with a clear lead. Here comes to it. He pops over it well. Lucky Ganesha flicks to the top in second place. Back in third, we've got Mountain Dream and Kirsham, but playing for places only as the runaway winner here is Mutardi, who's coming home in grand style here. And at the line, it's going to be Mutardi who wins it in the end quite easily. As they come down towards the second from home, but El Salida coming stand side, Shrivar is on the right. This is the second from home, the three will be in the air together, and Shrivar is a faller! Would you believe it, when he came there absolutely cantering, he's covered in mud. It's El Salida with the advantage now to Commonwealth in second place. Horse and jockey appear to be okay. This is the final flight. El Salida with a 3-5 lead now over Commonwealth in second. Squandermania is through for third. And as they battle inside the last 150 yards, El Salida with the advantage here. A clear 1-2 over Commonwealth. And at the line, El Salida wins his third race. As they come down towards the second from home, he stood off a long way on Stonehill, got away with it. Lerpak Legend looks held now back in a one pace fifth. It's Stonehill with the advantage as they come down towards the 12th and final fence in this novices handicap chase. It's Stonehill with the edge here to Little Warsaw, who hasn't given up yet in second place, under pressure trying to close. Candy Four and Bob's Buster and Lerpak Legend legless. Damien's Choice follows that, but Little Warsaw trying to press Stonehill as they race up towards the line. There's not going to be much in it as the line comes. Stonehill just holding on under Tony Dobbin, a double for him this afternoon. They've still got a furlong and a half to go. Can the front three come back to Running Moss? This is the final fence. It's Movie Man, very weary, very much out to his right. Morden Boy followed. Back in third place is Waterfont. And then comes Running Moss, who, funnily enough, is equally leg weary. Chagrin has faded like a damp squib. But this Movie Man is keeping up the gallop as they race inside the last 50 yards. It's going to be Movie Man who wins for the Beaumont Yard. Movie Man is the winner.
Our bookies love it. Not a single favourite successful. Races live on Channel 4. Winchester wins the first at 9-4, second best. Mutardi 16-1 in the 1:30. El Salida 9-1 in the 2 o'clock with a defeat of the 3-1 on chance. 2:30 Stonehill at 9-2. 3 o'clock Movie Man at 10-1. And Tashreef, the 11-4 second favourite, wins the 3:30. And the tote returns for that Tashreef, who was 11-4. Clear second favourite, that Tashreef, £3.70. He wins on the tote. The places are £1.20 and £12.90 for Over the Beck. Exacta £149.70. Computer Straight forecast £104.18. And for that Alan Dempsey, that failure, that fall off, the major, a body blow for punters.
Well, Alan Dempsey's here now. Fortunately, the first question, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine, thanks. Yeah.
John was a little bit critical of the horse, what you did with the horse 2 out. He felt, in hindsight, you might have been more positive. What's your reaction to that?
The reason being, not being positive, as Mr. Frankham says, the horse made a dreadful blunder down the back. Mm-hmm. And I've sat on him, hoping to get his confidence. He got in a little bit close to the next one. And then the last down the back, he's jumped it well. Now, I'm travelling very well going to 3 out. He's popped it grand. And rather than putting the gun to his head, because his confidence, I think, is probably a little bit shady after that bad mistake, I even just brought him down the fence a little bit so he could have a little bit more room for himself, because I didn't feel there was a stride there. I could have asked him...
Here we go to it now, Alan.
I could have asked him for a big one, but the horse has already put down when I asked him for a big one down the back. So rather than not... I mean, he jumped it fine, but just left his back ones in it. And rather than driving down to it and sort of not so much frighten him, but deck him.
Yeah.
That was what I thought was the best thing to do, really.
Anyway, I mean, John only made a point. He wasn't critical about that, but I know you took exception. You were watching earlier when you came back in, and in support of you, Robert Earnshaw came out and he said he hopes John and John McCruick will watch the whole race through tonight. You didn't agree with the comments about Miller Freak. They thought you were too easy on her.
Yes, Miller Freak is, she ran in the plate today, in the Sellen Hurdle today. I rode her last time over 2.5 miles in Musselburgh. Now, the tactics were, before I rode her in Musselburgh, she hadn't been getting home because she was ridden close to the pace. So in Musselburgh, it was 2.5 miles. I dropped her in and got her to pass horses and she finished sixth. They made her favourite today, fair enough. But don't forget, that was 2.5 miles in Musselburgh.
Yeah.
Today, sticky ground, 2 miles. And she's the type of filly that will go through horses on the bridle. She likes to pass horses, get her confidence.
So you tried to do the same thing again today?
Whereas today, I'm having to niggle her.
Yeah.
You know, she's jumped the first fine, she stepped to the second and landed on top of it. And then I'm trying to ride a race on her, get her to pass horses without actually getting after her. Try to ride a sweet race on her to get her to pass, but that wasn't the case.
So you think they were unfair on you then?
Yes, everybody's entitled to their own opinion.
You've had your say. Thanks for coming and talking to us. A lot of people wouldn't have been brave enough to come back and sort of face the cameras. We wish you well. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, it's a very easy sitting here, pass and comment. Let's have a look at the champion tipster details. The maximum points available today, 191 points. Claims required for 115 points or more. The number to ring, 0990 100 366.
Well, it's a bit sparky up here, isn't it? But there you are, it's all about opinions, and well done to Alan Dempsey for coming and standing his ground. Equally, John's a man of vast experience, and he said what he saw. Just a little bit of information. Sue Montgomery rang in, the journalist from The Independent on Sunday. The technical words that I gave John, in fact, to use regarding myself's foal weren't, strictly speaking, correct. Bay is the dominant gene. It's not really a subject we can go into in detail now, but if that was imparted wrongly at the other end, that's down to me. I did that research, or you could say lack of it. Finally, I do want to say a big thank you to Christopher Tetley, to Adrian Swingler, the groundsman here, and John Gundle, who've made us very welcome, and also to our hard-working team who've been rushing everywhere over the last month to rig everything up and keep us on the road, and we hope you've enjoyed it, controversial or not. We'll see you next time. Back to you, Simon.
Yeah, thank you, Jim, and well done to Catterick for at least keeping the show on the road this afternoon. It is very easy sitting in the warm here, isn't it, commenting on another.
I admire the way that he rides. I wasn't being critical of his ride on Miller Freak. I was just saying that the stewards should have looked into it. I'm not saying that there wasn't a reason for it. And you're riding a horse and you don't know whether it's broken a blood vessel or what's happened, but I'm just saying that whatever it was, looking at it how we looked at it, they should have had an inquiry.
Right, we'll be tying up a few loose ends 60 seconds from now. We'll be back.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
With its unique control blade independent rear suspension, the Ford Focus gives you ultimate control. And Ford's clear price policy means you can drive one away from just £10,495.
Hello, Sarah. Is this poster right? It's the Royal Bank of Scotland credit card. It says 3.9% APR, but that seems ridiculous. Fixed till January 2002, right. So, could I get one? Well, great. All I need now is the telephone number. 0800 16 16 16.
To apply for a credit card with the Royal Bank of Scotland at just 3.9% APR, call now on 0800 16 16 16.
Sport on 4 with StepStone Online Recruitment.
Yeah, just one or two things to wrap up here at Lingfield. First of all, the picture puzzle, the solution today was, you horrible little, it was Private Seal, and our £100 winners, Barry Nightingale from Stainforth in Doncaster, will be up there hopefully next Saturday. Margaret Davis from Congleton in Cheshire, and Mrs. J. Jacobs from Clacton-on-Sea in Essex. And talking of next Saturday, a big meeting, and let's hope it goes ahead at Cheltenham. We're a bit starved of good jump racing in the last 2 or 3 weeks. A star-studded programme there, highlighted by the Pillar Property Chase at 2:50, a renowned trial for the Cheltenham Gold Cup, as well as the Ladbroke Trophy Handicap Chase at 4:05. And at Doncaster, big doubleheader next Saturday. The Potemps Great Yorkshire Chase is run at Doncaster at 3:10, and the Potemps Mansion House Handicap Chase over 2 miles, a flying 2-miler there as well. So plenty to look forward to there. Thanks very much to John Frankham for joining us. We've had a disgusting display of gluttony this afternoon.
It's empty.
From John McCrick.
There's nothing in the bottle.
Finished his bottle of champagne without offering us any. Do join us next week for the Pillar Chase at Cheltenham. It was no worries 12 months ago for Looks Like Trouble, who went on to win the Gold Cup. I wonder if we'll see another Gold Cup winner next weekend. Join us then.
On 4 with Stepstone Online Recruitment.
The Channel 4 racing calendar, price £6.99, is available in all good retailers, or you can order yours directly by calling the Channel 4 shop on 0870 1234 344. Don't forget to include £1.95 postage and packing for phone orders.